I'm Ben.
I'm sorry.
If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. As Sori says, 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the alliance. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes!
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insori@gmail.com and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we can't guarantee a positive review. Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is the community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Shh. Message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. What? Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah, yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go in the village, facebook.com/BenAndSori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community, connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Buy merch indeed. A child shall lead them.
To buy our merch.
Yes, dear listener. Yes, dear listener. Yes, dear listener.
Okay.
All right, guys, listen. We are once again trying our dual mic attempt. So Sori doesn't like the attempt. I do. Guys, let us know if you hear the dreaded echo.
Yeah. Are we sounding good? Do we sound like we're in a can? Do we sound
so if we sound
like
good
the
right
reverb
now,
is too loud.
If we sound good right now, type 22. If we sound like junk or if there's an echo, please let me know. Okay. Right now, we've got a DJ stream on the way, but we are waiting for the big homie to show up. So what we're going to do is we're going to listen to... Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
We are... Sori is great, Vin. Slight echo.
Of course!
Thank you, Amy.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
I just don't know if we should just...
I muted it. It's okay. I told you, it's not that big of a deal. Look, all right. I did was mute it, and we're back in.
All right, that's excellent. It. Okay, good. Okay. All right, so we have Jessica from our channel that has requested this song, Rise Against, Hero of War. She said, hey, I would love for you guys to review this song, Hero of War, by Rise Against. Here is the link for the lyric video, and she also has the official video link that she wants us to watch on the side. She said, I think it would be great for you two to watch this one on the side. Thanks. Love you too, Jessica.
Okay.
All right, Jessica. We are about to get into this song for you.
This is the name of the band. It's Rise Against, Hero of War.
Yep.
From the album Appeal to Reason. Let's do this shit.
He said, son, have you seen the world? Well, what would you say if I said that you could just carry this gun? You'll even get paid. I said that sounds pretty good. Black leather boots, spit shine so bright. They cut off my hair, but it looks alright. We marched and we sang. We all became friends as we learned how to fight. A hero of war, yeah, that's what I'll be. And when I come home, they'll be damn proud of me. I'll carry this flag Cause it's a flag that I love and a flag that I trust. I kicked in the door, I yelled my commands. The children, they cried, but I got my man. We took him away, a bag over his face, from his family and his friends. They took off his clothes, they pissed in his hands. I told them to stop, but then I joined in. We beat him with guns and batons, not just once, but again and again. A hero of war, yeah, that's what I'll be. And when I come home, they'll be damn proud of me. I'll carry this flag to the grave if I must, cause it's a flag that I love and a flag that I trust. She walked through bullets and haze. I asked her to stop, I begged her to stay, but she pressed on. So I lifted my gun and I fired away. And the shells jumped through the smoke and into the sand that the blood now had soaked. She collapsed with a flag in her hand, a flag white as snow. A hero of war, is that what they see? Just medals and scars, so damn proud. And I brought home that flag. Now it gathers dust, but it's the flag that I love. It's the only flag I trust. He said, son, have you seen the world? Well, what would you say if I said that you could?
Hero of war, wow. Rise against.
Oh my gosh, wow. That is... Those lyrics were... They were pretty raw, you know? I remember we watched something. I don't know if it was a show or a movie or something, but like... You were seeing guys kind of in that situation. I got a little confused in the middle there because I thought that he broke into some place to get his friends. I kicked in the door. I yelled my commands. The children, they cried, but I got my man. Yeah. I thought my man was like his buddy.
No,
I didn't realize. Target. I know. I realized that after. And then we took him away, a bag over his face. I heard for his family and friends. So I thought that they were taking his buddy back because he had gotten killed, but they were taking his body back to his family. And then when it says they took off his clothes, I was like, well, I guess maybe...
What? No. Where are you getting body? He wasn't dead.
I know. I'm saying I misunderstood.
Oh.
So then it was a real shocking twist when they started, like, hurting the person and pissing in his hands and all of a sudden I'm like, what's happening? And then I realized, oh my gosh. Okay. Because do you remember that thing that we had seen where the kid came back?
Yeah, yeah.
And yeah, basically, you know, everybody was like, you know, did you kill anybody? And trying to like find out all this information. And like, he was so different and he was so changed. And, man, that's, and then the story of the girl was trying to surrender. Ugh.
Yeah, I mean, the girl trying to surrender is a terrible situation. I mean, this guy's never really been in that situation, but there's a lot of times when dudes didn't do that and people died because of it.
I'm sure.
You know, like these guys.
Yeah.
You know, they took a mentally retarded kid and strapped him up with a vest and then sent him into the souk, the market. Like, that's the type of people that there were. So,
yeah.
You know, the guys would much rather have to sing that song about hitting the girl with the white flag than have to sing about how they let somebody go and now they got to go home and tell this guy's daughter that he's not coming home because he was being a nice guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah. You know, it's you know, like I said, you know, on the one hand, the concept of a righteous kill is sounds so contradictory in terms, and obviously at some point it probably is a contradiction in terms, but it's used to differentiate people that you could feel good about killing versus people you don't feel good about killing.
Yeah.
And a lot of young people, especially, you know, 9/11, had this very black and white understanding of war and how war worked because all of us were ignorant about what was actually happening in the world. America pre-9/11 versus America post-9/11 is a completely different country and a different mindset. And especially after 9/11 happened, there was a lot of black and white talk. You're either with us or you're with the terrorists. Mm-hmm. You know, they made it sound like it was this global cabal of folks that were an existential threat to the United States instead of a very small group of really just operatives. I mean, really, if you think about it, I mean, what they pulled off, I mean, if you go with the mainstream story, what those Muhammad Atta and the rest of those boys pulled off was it was a high level intelligence hit. And mm-hmm. and there were discussions about how to engage that stuff and why you would bring in the mass of the US military as an occupying force, I think is at this point something that you just have to deal with as an American. Al-Qaeda was a very small group, very small operation with, they had decentralized leadership, but bin Laden was obviously the spiritual, ideological, philosophical leader. And so why did we need why did we need to lean in so much with the full weight of the U.S. military is today a question that's unanswered at the popular level. But you put a bunch of young people who, in my view, obviously I'm biased, but in my view, joined for virtuous reasons. I remember, like, literally, like, tasting blood in my mouth when I was watching all this shit happen in 9/11. I was just at my house.
Yeah.
I was just at my, and watching people jump from the towers and anything like that. Like, that right there, like, that pushed me over the edge. And I just remember saying, like, yo, a lot of people are going to die for this shit. I was very happy. I was like, people are going to die over this shit. We're going to kill a lot of people over this shit. And I, you know, I was ballistic for about, I don't know, a year and a half, 2 years.
Yeah, I felt like, yeah, people need to die. Like, they need to learn. But I was naive to the fact that civilians and children were going to die as casualties in that. I had no idea.
I knew civilians were going to die, but my thing was, you know, and you know, that's why I'm so crazy about propaganda to this day. You know, like the infographics thing right here, which is just a CIA cutout on YouTube. But anyway. Well, I just said that. I knew that civilians were going to die, but my thing was, nobody in Al-Qaeda is a declared combatant from any given country. Terrorist organization are essentially militarized civilians. Mm-hmm. So if you look at it from that perspective, I was like, yep, a lot of civilians are going to die, but fuck them. Because at the time, what was in my head was, yo, everybody's like this, bro. Like, there are exceptions, and, you know, let Allah figure them out. You send them all to Allah, but and Allah will figure out who the innocent ones are. But my mentality was, man, fuck these people. All of them. All of them need to die. All of them are supporting Al-Qaeda. Everybody's celebrating. I had no idea how propaganda worked, how psychological operators worked. I didn't know how any of that stuff worked. Mm. Of course, looking back now at all these old broadcasts, now they're plain as day. The movies that were released around the time period, which is really, really fishy. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of guys. There's a lot of guys where Black Hawk Down was like the thing, and that came out.
Did it happen fast? Like when 9/11 happened, and then those propaganda films, whatever, came out. Thank you so
well,
much.
Well, no, I'm the news. The news was mainly propaganda. Fox News before every broadcast.
Zoe.
No matter what they were talking about.
Yellow Red Bull.
No matter what they were talking about, hey, what's going on, Ms. Johnson? No matter what they were talking about, they would always start with the planes hitting the towers, explosion in the tower, and then you'd see a bunch of, you know, Green Berets jumping out of a Humvee.
Yeah,
they would also play the people celebrating in the street, supposedly, yada, yada, yada. A lot of those videos were just, you know, archive footage from actual mourners in Palestine who their kids had just been killed. But Fox was playing that and saying, look, these guys are dancing in the streets. Because that helped to communicate that the civilians were in on it. And so in my mind, there was no distinction between a civilian and a combatant. Jeez. You know what I'm saying? And in my mind, I'm like, okay, like, you know, it's hard, like, when you
That's
see
so crazy.
People that, like, represent you are just getting murdered and slaughtered and you can't do anything about it. I was just sitting there, like, watching people jump off buildings and, like, thinking to myself, like, how fucked up do you have to be to choose that as a way to go out because there was no other way out? And I was just like, man. So I was successfully, you know, propagandized pretty well. And so was, you know, but it's like I said about the other thing. Well, I just got done a Middle America episode, and I was talking about, you know, these people that stormed the Capitol, you know, and the things, the insane things that those people were saying, on a public forum like. You know, Parler, where, you know, trying to explain to people the ramifications of what a war like Iraq and Afghanistan does to the mind of a person.
Oh, gosh.
So this guy says, now this is relative to the January 6th stuff. I'm locked and loaded, ready to stack bodies as soon as President Trump gives a green light. Mr. Woods, sir, signed, my oath never ended, a combat vet. His nickname here is Jaro, which probably means he's in the Marine Corps. And he says, my oath never ended because when you sign up, it says you swear to defend the Constitution of America against enemies both foreign and domestic. And I was explaining that a lot of these guys, when you come back and you go to sleep, you know, insomnia is a massive, massive issue with a lot of these guys. You go to sleep, and when you close your eyes, you see the sprawled out body of a kid who couldn't be more than 12, and he's got sandals at his feet because he's so poor that he couldn't even afford to get shoes to do jihad properly. And it's like, yeah, man, that's the guy that you killed. Like, even if the guy was going to kill your friend,
yeah,
you can't. You don't feel like a hero, and so you were pumped full of all of this virtue, and you were willing to die and kill for your country, and you were clearly attacked. And in our, you know, in your mind at the time, it's like, yo, they clearly attacked us. These were clearly civilians. There's no way around this. People have to fucking die. Period. End of story. Like,
And if you look at the situation in isolation, yeah, you went after a bunch of, you killed civilians in the World Trade Center. But we were not being, even on, quote, left-wing media, there was no balance whatsoever. It was univocal across the board that we're absolutely going to war. There's no question. There was no nothing. We're going to bomb the shit out of these people. We're going to fuck them up, period. That's it. And anything we do to end these people is completely green-lighted. I remember when the Abu Ghraib stuff first came. Abu Ghraib was where it was released that we were torturing these people and doing like really, really horrible shit to these people. In Islam,
is it?
Go ahead.
For what? Why are we doing this? Why were we torturing them?
I mean, intelligence. You know, so in Islam, I mean, you know this. In Islam, there's a very high primer on. It's a shame honor culture. There's a very big primer on cleanliness. I mean, literally, like, Muhammad said that the dwellers of hell, like, if you don't wash very well after you use the bathroom, there's a special place in hell for you, right? So, like, I'm not commenting on the logic or whatever of that particular decree. Mm-hmm. I'm just showing you the mindset of a lot of these Islamic folks. It's a very shame, honor-oriented type of culture. And so, and Abu Ghraib, which is what he was referring to when he talking about they pissed at his hands and all the rest of it, is they did specific things relative to the Islamic religion to these people. And they took specific elements of their culture, namely how men and women interact. The Islamic, I mean, you know, especially like, you know, Wahhabist sort of Sunni Islam, Salafist Islam. You know, when we're listening and how Muhammad was with women and how women were, you know, treated in society. And so you've got this Arab man or Iraqi man being led around by this woman and they're taking pictures of it. And so, like, you quickly find out, okay, you got a group of people here who are willing to die. They're blowing themselves up. So you can't just threaten to kill them. So it was, you know, the bad side of this is that the intelligence was absolutely effective. If you look at when that program started and the type of people that we were able to line up after, I mean, nobody's going to come out and say this, but it was massively effective. It was a lot more effective than waterboarding and all this other stuff. Like, this is, people have to understand, like, the shit that they were doing, the psychological warfare, absolutely garnered results. And it was a lot more successful than the physical stuff, including the waterboarding.
That's, wow.
And so, I mean, you had guys, you know, you had the box in contorted positions or whatever, and they were just people that were just like, you just hit a level where you're completely zoned out because it's so traumatic that the brain just like, you just hit a ceiling. In other words, you put them in a box like a mega contorted. Remember that movie we saw where they put the girl in the box? The box is like this big, basically. Yeah. And I mean, it's claustrophobia. I mean, it's your joints.
But they're twisting them and sticking them in there like that?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, very little movement. Oh my God. What people found was that people hit kind of a ceiling where
just
kind of
zoned.
It just, but with the psychological stuff that they were doing, it was a completely different way of fucking with a person, and people became very, very compliant because they don't want that spread. Because it's not only like, you, okay, well, I'll just kill myself for shame. It's also, you have a son, you have a daughter, you have a wife. They are also carrying that for the rest of their lives. And we don't understand what that's like on our side, because we have people walking around naked. People voluntarily walk around naked in America. Their culture is completely different, and so it was extremely effective. And so, but my point is, when you realize that, look, if you're fighting the Nazis, you're fighting an enemy that's very evil, but on top of being extremely evil, extremely capable fighters. The Germans had better tech than us. They were obviously a lot more disciplined in certain areas and things like that. They had masterminds. They had mad scientists. If you killed a German, I mean, nobody's going to understand this, but if you kill the German, you can feel good about it. You're in a firefight, and then you go and, you know, you look at the field afterwards, and it's a bunch of
kids or people with Kalashnikovs that are, you know, and it's a different kind of feeling, and you feel it's just a crazy feeling, and you don't feel like you're an actual, you're like, you feel like, it's like Michael Jordan was talking about how he got in a fight with Steve Kerr, and, you know, Michael Jordan, Steve Kerr is like barely 6 feet tall, he's white, skinny, you know, Michael Jordan's at the peak of his physical powers, and then he said he went home and he felt this big. Mm-hmm. Because when you go all out against somebody and you realize how much you outmatch them, it just doesn't, so you're like, oh, this is the guy. So my point is, these guys go home and you have that Ronin syndrome where it's like, what's my purpose? What am I here for? But on top of the Ronin syndrome, you also have the people that I did kill, like, what, you know, like they were,
you can't feel good about all of it. Yeah.
So now you've got this giant gaping hole where you desire combat because there's no adrenaline rush like it, but you also want to be able to, it's a weird feeling, but you want to be able to kill somebody that deserves it.
Oh, I mean, that makes sense.
And kill somebody that's matched to you. You know what I'm saying? And so now you've got hundreds of thousands of guys that have come back from that theater, and now they've got their sights set on the government. And it's the government that's the problem. It's the FBI. It's all these people, blah, 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 blah. And so we need to load up and go to war with them, because if you kill an FBI operative, for example, or a CIA operative, that's a person who's trained to the nines and is a worthy opponent. And these guys are taking part in some crazy thing to molest little kids. So now you're doing it for a completely virtuous reason. And that's why the Pizzagate, like the psychology of the Pizzagate and everything jumped out, was because there are very few obviously wrong and right issues in the world today. And kids seem to be the final sort of bastion of, okay, we're not even going to consider this discussion. Right? So, like, you hurt a child sexually, there's no fucking discussion. Like, across the board, there's no discussion. And so that checks, like, okay, I'm killing a bad person because you hurt a child. There's no moral ambiguity. Mm-hmm. It's not like going overseas and you're like, yeah, you had this whole thing about people. Then you talk to these people and they're regular kids like you. They're funny. They have a certain kind of candy they like. They'll kick their soccer ball to you, that type of thing. They admire you. They ask you if you're from the planet, if you're from Earth. They say something to you in Arabic. You go to the translator, and the guy asks you, like, what planet are you from, and all the rest of this shit. It becomes, and then later on, you kill that same kid. So how's the person supposed to live with themselves after that shit? So you go home, and you're carrying all that shit. You're carrying that inside of you, and then you get, and now you're like, yo, I need a war to justify myself and my existence and my purpose. And so these guys come home and they love this Pizzagate shit because it's about child molest. They keep telling you child predator, child. Why is that the issue? Mm-hmm. It sounds so crazy. It's because there's no moral ambiguity relative to that. But there is a ton of moral ambiguity that we were not told after 9/11. Okay, so you want to be able to just say, yep, this guy was totally bad, and I did what needed to be done, and I fought a worthy opponent. These guys are trained to the nines. So, that's why, like, all of this instigation that's happening in our country, like, people are playing with fire. They don't know what they're doing.
Yeah.
You know, you get these weird people, these QAnon people, like, they have no idea what they're doing. And the psychology of the people that follow them, because the psychology of the people that follow QAnon, they're almost exactly the same profile, especially if you're a dude and you follow that shit. So, you know, it's tough. You know, it's a tough thing that people have to deal with. But then it's like almost centering the perpetrator in this song. Like, we're the perpetrators, but you feel sorry for the guy. Like, oh man, look what they fucked up this kid and took his innocence. But at the end of the day, it's like, yo, you joined in that shit, man. They were torturing that guy, and you felt bad at the beginning, but then you jumped in.
Yeah,
and you have to. You have to. Because you go back, people are like, yo, what the fuck? What's going on? So, you know, the more I look at it, there's no real difference between that and the gang shit that happens in Chicago. There's none. There's that. I mean, there are certain rules of engagement in Chicago that, you know, CB could talk about. There are even rules of engagement in New York when we were beefing with people, but I don't know. Horrible. Horrible shit. I really, this is a silent count for me. Shout out to Jessica. It's a very, very important song. And I think it's still very pertinent. And I think there's a blind spot in a lot of people relative to, and that's why, you know, I was pleading with people at the end of the Middle America episode just now to like, yo, if you're going to say something, you're going to post something on the internet, please make sure it's factual. Because a lot of people don't have this kind of background. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And so if you're not looking like really deeply in the shit that you're saying, you could be fueling an insane zeitgeist that can really, 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 really harm people. So yeah, there's that. I'm going to give this one a silent count. Tough stuff.
Yeah,
it was a good song, but
yeah, I mean, I think that it's a really hard. It was a hard song to listen to because, well, obviously, I didn't know that things were the way that they are when we're talking, you know, military and what the guys go through and what they're involved in and how complicated it gets and how morality works or doesn't work and like you have an idea of what you think it is. And then, you know, obviously the older that you get, the more conversations you have with different people and the more stuff that you learn. And then you realize that, like, that, because it never really made sense to me, like, what was going on when the guy came back. Honestly, before having all the conversations that I had over the past few years, I used to be so annoyed with the situation. I'm like, these poor women, like, they stood by this guy. He went off and he did his, you know, his G.I. Joe shit, and then he came back, and the whole time that he's gone, she can't wait for him to return, and when he comes back, he's not engaging with her, he's, you know, whatever, and I was like, what, how, why are they expecting so much from these women? But then I didn't realize, like, everything that was going on for the guy when he was gone, because to me, it was like, I didn't realize, I mean, obviously, I've never killed anybody, so I didn't realize the effect that taking another life has on a human being, and how even if it's a justified killing, it still has an effect when you take somebody's life. And so because I didn't realize that, I was like, oh, you know, here these guys go, they get to go over there, kill some people. Again, I wasn't thinking it was any big deal because it's almost normalized when it's kind of talked about that, you know, there's soldiers and there's cops and there's, you know what I mean? So I had no idea everything that goes on, and then, you know, obviously I've learned a lot of things about it. And then this song fit in with a lot of the stuff that I had heard and how the things go, and you could hear from this guy that he wasn't proud of it all, and the way that he was singing the, you know, like a hero of war part after he would say all that stuff, it was like, okay, yeah, that's gonna be like, I don't like it if somebody like gives me props for something that I didn't necessarily do. And, I mean, even, like, last night, like, I did a lot of the cooking for supper. I mean, this is so mild, but the kids did help me. And so when you were like, oh, this is an amazing meal, I'm like, well, you know what, a lot of help. You know what I mean? Like, so I can see how if you go and all this other stuff is in the back of your head, and then you have people saying, oh, you're a hero of war, like, you're our hero, blah, 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 like, how difficult that would be to hear, because you're basically, like, probably scoffing at it within yourself. I totally understand the silent count aspect of it. His voice basically stayed the same throughout the song. It wasn't a lot of variation. But it was the storyline, I thought, and what he was saying was so real and so raw. It didn't necessarily need a whole bunch of stuff. I'm going to match you with the silent count because I do think that it's a heavy and difficult topic, and anyone that I've ever spoken to that's been in this situation, it's an ongoing fight for them. So shout out to anyone who's been there and anyone who's seeking forgiveness for the things that haunt them still to this day. Yeah, so silent counts all around.
Yeah, I think that's one of the reasons I admire millennials so much, because I look at millennials and I'm like, they'd never fall for this shit.
Oh.
And I love them for that. They're so savvy and they know so much more about the world than we did. And a lot of that has just to do with...
We have the internet, so they can see a lot more, learn a lot more.
Well, we had the internet too. Oh, we just didn't care.
We didn't have it.
We just didn't care. I didn't care. I cared about girls, and I cared about the Valley Mob and the Blood Gang and all the other folks that were. I was worried about my own little skirmishes. I didn't give a fuck about what happened in the world. So, I've got a lot more hope for the millennials, because they're in a post 9/11 America, they have no choice but to be cognizant about what's happening in the world. And the other crazy thing is they have friends all over the world now. You know what I'm saying? And so, can you imagine, like, yo, we're going to Afghanistan, we're going to kill a bunch of people. It's like, yo, I know, this guy sent me pictures of his family and all that shit. What do you mean? What are we going to kill these people
for?
You know? So, I have a lot of... It's mind-boggling to me, the criticism of millennials. Older generations of people. It's like, number one, you are our parents. Number one, you're the one that raised us. So if we're whatever it is, it's your fault. But number two, like I said, man, these millennials they're dialed in.
Okay. Yeah. We'll help you out. 7:13.
7:13.
Send us an email.
No, don't send us an email. Put your PayPal. Put your PayPal address. Hey, Gabe's here. Put your PayPal address on the thingamajiggy. 7:13, and I'm sure the village will take care of you. Just put your PayPal address in the comment section. We'll take care of it. Okay. Really, really good song, Jessica. Very important, and it's still relevant to today because. Mm. Not to scare anybody, but there are hundreds of thousands of young folks in America that that have come back now and have that deep emptiness, and they feel that only war is going to solve it. And so that's why this Trump shit is so dangerous. So dangerous. Okay, guys, and when I say the Trump shit, I mean both sides about the media, left-wing media, blue Democrat, neoliberal media, and Republican media relative to Trump are just adding more electricity and tension in the air, and it's pretty ugly, but we're going to figure it out, inshallah, we'll figure it out. Okay, so guys, let me peace out first, and then we'll take care of 7:13 after that. Okay, guys, that was a one-off. The man of the hour is here, Gabe.
Well, let's vent out so we're out, and
with
then
the,
we can
with the peer. So Gabe with the peer is up here. So we got Tenacious D. We got a lot of good bands coming up for you for the Gabe stream. Olive Garden was holding the big homie back for a little bit, so we did this song. We will peace out from this song, and then we will start the Gabe stream, bitches. Vin out.
Sorry out.
Gone. Okay, so 7:13 needs something to eat.
Yeah, Apple.
And drink.
Apple said he's going to help. River said he's going to help. So, soon as
here's
he...
the PayPal address is... where's the PayPal address, bro? Hold on. Where did he put it?
Oh, he did put it? I wasn't sure if he's going to be... like if it... it was gonna let him or not.
Yeah. What's your email on the PayPal address? Hey, shout out to my guy Revolutionist. The Revolutionist is here. Let me see. 713. There it is, right there. Okay, so that's it, right there. If you're on PayPal, it's SHANNOND007. So that's the name right there.
okay? So that's on PayPal or Cash App. And then 713, once you hit 20 bucks, we should be good to go, right? Because we're starving, we're thirsty, he hasn't eaten in a couple days, so maybe we can get him some groceries and all that good jazz. If you were going to super chat or anything like that, just send the super chat to that email address. Cash App address. I mean, the PayPal address. If you were going to send anything today, just send it to him. And I think we'll be able to take care of little bro that way.
There you go, guys. I spammed my own chat.
I got an email that a package from Maine is coming my way. Would that be you guys? Well, I don't know,
is that Revo? Mr.
Revolutionist. I don't know.
We maybe finally you, made it there.
Maybe you are getting something. Hey, Revo, if you get something from us, do me a favor and videotape it, huh? No, that's not how we do things over here. We don't pay things back, 713. We pay things forward. We don't pay back. We pay forward. So I'm sure there's a bunch of people in Houston that once you're up on your feet, you
that need your help.
You take care of those people, right? Once you're up on your feet, 713, you take care of those people. You know, we take care of our folks. It is what it is. Not a big deal. Just let me know once you hit about 20, 25 bucks or you get yourself a pizza or whatever, and you'll be good to go. And also, if you have a Cash App, most of us have Cash App too, so if you can figure out a way to get a Cash App thing going, that would be good too. All right, guys, the man of the hour is here. We're going to do the commercial, and then we're going to go right into our songs. We got a lot of really, really good songs for you guys coming up. Commercial break is on the way. 713 and I and Applejack will work on figuring out how to get this man his money. Get a Cash App, Mr. 713. All right, guys, commercial break, and then the man of the hour will be here. Let's go! I'm Ben.
I'm sorry.
If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It's sorry says 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of Alliance. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes.
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insori@gmail.com and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we can't guarantee a positive review. Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is the community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah, yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go in the village, facebook.com/vinandsori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community, connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Buy our merch indeed. A child shall lead them.
To buy our merch.
Yes, dear listener. Yes, dear listener.
All right.
This is the Gabe stream. The Gabe stream, dear listener. Gabe, the big homie, has gotten us 5 ridiculously amazing metal songs to listen to today. He is the DJ. You guys know the deal. If you get 4 songs or more, you can have a DJ stream. We just did. What did we do yesterday for a DJ stream?
Excuse me. That was the second half of Savatage.
Savatage. We did an entire record. A couple days ago, we did MF Doom. We did about 8 MF Doom songs. So I believe we're doing a reggae stream coming up. We are multicultural, dear listener, but it's you. If you are the DJ, you are the DJ. Everything is done exactly your way.
This is Vin, and I'm sorry.
Yeah.
For the uninitiated. Oh,
that's,
okay.
That's Rye. Shout out to Rye. Never seen you before. Good to see you.
Okay, so first song on Gabe's list tonight is from the band Idols. And the name of the song is Colossus. It's live on KEXP.
I cannot wait. I love live music.
He doesn't have anything to say on this one, though. Okay?
I love live music. I'm watching that Woodstock thing on...
You have? You've been watching it every night?
Not every night.
When I crash?
Not every night on Netflix, but...
There's a couple different ways of getting a DJ stream, but the way that Gabe went about it is...
Very patient man.
Yeah, well, you can jump on to buy on the one song per month tier, and you can wait until it accrues to be a stream. And so that's what Gabe decided to do. So it kind of just adds up for you there. And then once you've got four songs or more, we schedule you a stream. So there's lots of different ways. If you want to get it done and you're like, I'm not really sure, you can always just reach out to us and we'll kind of walk you through all the different options that there are to get to get a stream done.
Negative Vibes says, it wasn't until last fall that it dawned on me who Soraya was.
Oh my. All right.
You think our mother named her Sori? It sounds incomplete. Sounds like a nickname.
All right, you guys, let's get into this and see what this song
is. All right, song number one. We've heard this band before. Big homie. Idols? No.
All right.
All right, guys, let's see it. Here we go. Did I see the HBO thing on Woodstock? Yes. Yes, I did. I'm a bit offended about the way they made my boys look. So I had to say something to the homie. I was like, yo, man, fuck those people, bro.
You did? What did he say?
He was tight. He was mad. Yeah. I'll tell you later.
Yeah, I was going to say, tell me off camera.
Said. I'll tell you later what he said. But I'm like, fuck you, man.
Yeah.
You try to make Korn look like the bad guys and Bush like he was like some like Jesus figure. Like, this is not what Woodstock is about. Man, shut the fuck up. What do you know about it? All right, let's go. Now you're not being difficult, man. Just get us the info. All right, here we go, guys. Idols, Colossus, big homie Gabe. Let's do this shit. Can you hear anything?
No.
Okay, we're good. Oh, look at that room. Where are the lyrics at? Where are the lyrics?
He's got the link right in there.
I got it.
And it goes. and it goes and it goes, goes and it goes and it goes, goes and it goes and it goes, goes and it goes and it goes.
That people behind the glass.
Discover new music at listener-powered-kexp.org.
I don't think we will discover anything from you anymore, KXP. You guys destroyed our stream! The stream is currently unavailable. If you're watching this in...
Gabe says, KXP has been cool in the past. Guess not anymore.
If you're watching this in real time, dear listener... actually, you're probably seeing the edited version. Oh, you've definitely seen the edited version.
Yeah, I'm just going to cut this out.
Because we don't cut up the songs every 2 seconds, it's so funny seeing Delaney say, I love 90s music. So funny to me. The Matrix was written in the early late 1900s. It's still applicable today. Holy shit. Okay. Oh, did you get his right PayPal address?
I got a link that like brings you right there.
Oh, from his email?
Yeah, and it brings you right here.
Boop. Okay. All right. So that was Idols. Guys, type 20. I'll tell the guys in the thing to type 22 when they get back. We'll start the review now. When y'all get back in. These are the dangers that happen when you're trying to be pure to the art form. We don't believe in cutting up songs, like interrupting the song and all that. A lot of other reactors do. And a lot of other reactors are awesome, by the way. And
shout out to them. Like, subscribe.
You should like, share, and subscribe other reactors because they're badasses in their own right. But we don't do that. And so because of that, you're a lot more liable to get hit with a copyright claim because of that. But that's okay. That's what we do. That's what we do, dear listener. And I think we're back, so we could start the review now.
We're not back.
Oh, we're not back yet. Okay. So, yeah. I mean, that's the long and the short of it. I was like, yeah, this kind of looks like very official to me. Let me see if it was the actual band's. Yeah, KEXP. It's got 2.7 million subscribers. So, yeah. They're pretty big, but that's okay. So do me a favor and restart that thing to see if we're back yet.
Mm-hmm.
I think we should be back by now, but you know we get blocked every. All right, Revolution.
Here we go. We're back.
Okay. Okay. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it, Gabe. It is what it is. you guys know why we get blocked, and you know because we're trying to stay true to the art form.
Yeah.
Okay. What did you think the song was about, Missy?
Well, it's crazy because when it first started, I thought it sounded like the
Idols. What's the name of the song? Colossus.
Yeah. Okay. I thought that it sounded like the Prodigal Son.
Okay. That's interesting. How so?
Well, so at the beginning, he's just saying, I was down, I was done in one weekend. The weekend lasted 20 years. The world's best, I don't know what that means.
Bulimic bartend? That means he's got bulimia, which is interesting because dudes generally, or let me say stereotypically, don't struggle with bulimia.
Yeah, I obviously know what bulimia is. That was surprising to me. That's why I said I don't know what that is, because it was unexpected, yeah.
Like you couldn't process that a dude was saying that he had bulimia, basically?
Yeah. Tender, violent, and queer. Okay, so I didn't actually hear verse 1. Verse 2, Father, forgive me, I have sinned. I've drained my body full of pins. I've danced till dawn with splintered shins. Full of pins. So, I mean, I'm sure this seems to me like such a typical story that everybody knows it. But the prodigal son is basically essentially about this son that decides that he wants to leave his father's house. But this is way back in the ancient Near East. So he was the father. His money was wrapped up in his property and in his belongings, like his animals and stuff like that. So when the kid said, hey, I want my inheritance right now, the dad basically had to sell off half his stuff right then. But the father does it, the son leaves, and he just parties away all of his inheritance. And life gets really, really difficult for him. And then he ends up realizing he has zero money left because everybody was ready to party with him when he had the money, and then people are gone when the money's gone. So he ends up having to get a job. So does he have enough?
Yeah.
Thanks, guys, for helping out with that. So anyway, so he gets a job feeding pigs, which in that day and age, the pigs were considered like they shouldn't have been around them, right?
Yeah, they were unclean.
Yeah. So he participates in taking care of these pigs. And after a while, he's like, why am I even doing this? Like, I can just go back to my dad's house and I can be a servant over there and it would be better off. My dad's servants were treated better than I'm getting treated here. So then he decides to just go home and be his dad's slave, basically. So he heads home, and the father sees him in the distance, which means he was probably always looking every day for his son. And the father runs to the son, which is a crazy part because they didn't run. But he did. He loved his son. So anyway, so he runs over there, and he brings his son back. They have a celebration, and so on and so forth. So the kid comes back home. And that's called the story of the prodigal son. Well, this one, Father, forgive me, I have sinned. I've drained my body full of pins. I've danced with splintered shins, full of pins, full of pins. Goes it. They laugh at me when I run. I wasted away for fun. I am my father's son. His shadow weighs a tone?
Ton.
Oh, okay. They spelled that off oddly. So that's why I thought it was about the prodigal son. But then, obviously, as it gets to the end of the song, then he starts talking about, I don't want to be your man.
Yeah, where are you seeing any reconciliation? I have no idea where you're getting the prodigal son reference.
Like, from the kid's perspective, from the son's perspective, when he says, they laugh at, well, forgive me, Father, I have sinned. I've drained my body full of pins. I've danced till dawn with splintered shins full of pins. Like, the prodigal son coming into the realization of what he's done, like,
I don't think he thinks any of this stuff is wrong.
Because he says, I am my father's son. I don't think it's about the prodigal son, babe. I'm just saying, you asked me what I thought it was. I don't
see any correlation between that at all. I'm trying to figure out, where are you seeing the...
I didn't see verse 1. Verse 2, he's asking for his father's forgiveness and talking about draining his body and dancing with splintered shins. And then he says that they laugh at him. I am my father's son, he said. His shadow weighs a ton. Like, it just seemed like it was him realizing, well, I'm my father's son. Like, I'm going back home. People laughing at him and stuff. So I just thought it was that. Father, forgive me, I have sinned. But then it went into, I don't want to be your man. And then I'm like Stone Cold Steve Austin. I put homophobes in coffins. I was like, okay, I'm wrong.
I think when he says I'm my father's son, he's not saying that positively. He's saying that because it validates the next line, which is his shadow weighs a ton. So he's always dealing with the masculinity of his father in the background that he can't live up to. So he's a bulimic bartender who's tender, violet, and queer. Bulimia is not a very masculine issue to have. Like Adonis syndrome, you know, the guys that go to the gym and can't, like, stop.
Yeah.
That's kind of, like, supposed to be the male version of bulimia, is Adonis syndrome, where you're, like, overworking yourself in the gym. And even though it's a mental malady, it's a masculine malady because the byproduct is you have a G.I. Joe type body. Mm-hmm. But this guy is not even man enough to have Adonis syndrome. He's got bulimia, which is...
Yeah, I see.
And then he's tender, violent, and queer. And these are, again, I think this is like dealing with the concept of masculinity itself.
Okay.
Because he's doing things that, you know, I always say this, like, we've got such simplistic understandings of people and what they are. And people are so multidimensional and multi-layered. So he's tender, but he's also violent. And he's also queer. And violence and queerness, again, doesn't go... Usually, the direction of the violence relative to the queer question is always going in one way, which is people are attacking queer people or being violent toward them. Mm-hmm. But what he's saying is, I'm tender, I'm also violent. I'm also queer. Mm-hmm. Which, obviously, if you think about, you know, the context of the Stonewall riots, like, they can get busy. There was this gay dude in the hood one time, and everybody knew he was gay as hell, bro. That man was gay as hell. And but nobody messed with him. He had one altercation with a person, and he beat the living shit out of that person. Yeah, and you know what's funny?
What?
It was before I showed up. He was a hood. It was a hood legend, basically, and nobody would say who it was that he beat the hell out of. But he beat the hell out of some dude, and he always used to walk around with his nine. His nine was always out. He's like, "This is not my dick," he'd say. "This is my, it's his gun, it's my gun," you know, like, and, you know, he was kind of, I wouldn't say he was accepted because he was always in, he was still kind of like on the outside, like you could tell, but he had the respect because, only because he was willing to display a certain level of violence. Mm-hmm. And, but it was just this weird thing, like, it was understood, like, yeah, you can't mess with that guy.
Yeah.
And the dude walking with him is, you know, whatever. But
But go ahead and fuck with him. You see what happened to you. Like, and he was in our hood, so everybody basically left him alone. But
wow.
Once I heard that hood legend, like, that was one of the things actually that helped me not fuck with gay people.
Really?
Because I'm like, yo, I can't lease to a gay dude in a fight, bro. Like, that's not, that's on set. Like, I'd have to go and, like, escalate that shit to another level. Like, I'm not going to take a loss to a gay dude. So then I thought to myself, you know what? Them dudes ain't going to fight you, bro. So just be nice to them. And that's literally, because when we first came to the block.
Wow.
When I first, you know, so that's, that literally, like, put me in a certain mind state relative to gay people. Shout out to that guy. I don't even know what the guy's,
wow.
I don't even know what the guy's name is. But believe you me, them boys get violent. Them boys can get violent. They're carrying a lot of, they're carrying a lot of pain themselves. You know what I'm saying? So,
yeah.
But oh yeah. Like that to me was a fate worse than death to like lose to a fight to a gay dude. Like if a girl hits you, like I've been hit by a lot of girls. You know, publicly hit by a lot of girls. I don't care. You know, because I'm like, what am I gonna do? Hit a female? Like I'm not gonna hit a female. You know what I'm saying? So you can kind of. But if a gay dude beats you up, like, ugh. I'm sorry, that's just how it is. But anyway. He's tender, violent, and queer. Forgive me, Father, I've sinned. I drain my body full of pins. I've danced till dawn with splintered shins. Again, dancing is not a topic, especially the way that these guys were doing it. And it was really fascinating, like, listening to him because I didn't see any queerness whatsoever with this guy. He looked like a typical, regular, what you would consider masculine type guy.
Yeah, I agree. I thought, like, when I was watching it, it was so, it was strange, and I appreciate strange art, because I think it communicates something lost within certain souls, but, so I liked it. I liked the oddities of it, and just watching their body movements, and the way that he was singing it, just the whole thing was just very odd. And you're right. I didn't look at him and think that he would be, you know, I thought he was just, you know, I didn't think that he was going to be gay or anything. I mean, I see he's using the word queer in the song.
Well, he's queer. It doesn't mean, like, he's gay, but it means he's queer.
Okay.
At minimum, it means he's transgressive of gender boundaries and expectations.
Yeah.
But it doesn't look like he ever really reconciled with his dad. He's talking about being in his dad's shadow, and his shadow weighs a ton, but it doesn't look like he and his dad ever really came to an understanding.
Well, I actually wasn't finished. So when I was watching the oddness of what they were doing, I was like, man, everybody like that wants to do art, I feel like that they should have an opportunity to participate in a song like this. Like, maybe not everybody. I don't think that everybody would need that. Like,
what do you mean?
I was like, man, I would love to just be in the studio with a crew of people that were this, like, odd. Doing music like this.
Yeah,
you know what
I
mean? Like the way that they were moving and just the way, like, they were expressing something that, I don't know. It just looked like that might loosen you up. You know what I mean? Like, you know what I mean? Like, just go in there and just have fun with it. Just be like, whatever, you know?
Yeah, so. These guys are definitely loose. He's definitely loose. They laugh at me when I run. I waste away for fun on my father's son. His shadow weighs a ton.
I waste away for fun. That's sad. That goes back to the bulimia thing, I guess.
Well, yeah, bulimia, drugs, you can fill in the blank with that one as far as, like, wasting away. But, again, laughing at a person when they run, you can imagine people saying, oh, you run like a girl, blah, blah, blah. I was rewatching Woodstock, and I was watching Korn Faggot. And, like, it reminded me that was another thing that helped me with the LGBT community because... I was like a Korn fan since Woodstock, so I went to listen to the previous records.
Yeah.
And then when Faggot came on, I was like, because I loved the band, I loved Jonathan. Like, you immediately, like, those are my people. So when I'm listening to the lyrics and I'm hearing what he's going through, you know, making fun of the way he walks, the way he talks. I was even watching a clip on Netflix. Where right before they were going on stage, Jonathan is hugging Monkey, but it's not a very masculine hug. It's like, and I'm like, yo, like, they made fun of this kid, almost drove the kid to suicide, you know, and he was able to, you know, so that was another reason why I was able to, you know, in the very, very, very imperfect way that we did, embrace the LGBT people at our school. Because mm-hmm. once we started walking around with the metal shit, people started, like, gravitating toward us because they didn't have anywhere, you know, anybody else yeah. to even hang out with them yeah. or understand them. And then, you know, a lot of those guys were, you know, a couple, there's this one kid, and not a lot of them, but this one kid who was super gay. Super, super gay. And he kind of, we would have never been caught dead or hung around with the guy if it wasn't for Korn. But because Korn had that song and Jonathan went through all that shit and I was, you know, me with the research, I went back and researched the song meaning and Jonathan was explaining, like, how it was for him in high school. I'm like, okay, I don't want to be like those people. But I was by no means like a social reformer. I mean, I remember the kid, I'm like, yo, I would tell the kid, like, yo, don't sit too close to me. Don't want, I was like, yo, don't, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, you give the pounds a little half hug to your friends. Like, I wouldn't do it with him. So I wasn't like a giant, but he was just in the crew and we wouldn't let anybody, you know, mess with him or whatever. But I was by no means like a progressive there at all. I was, you know, it was basically like, I didn't want him to get it confused, because you know how people are with me, especially, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so I didn't want like any of that shit to, you know what I mean?
Yep.
So, but yeah, like songs like these are important. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They're very, very important. I'm just not going to lie to you guys. Like, I was, you know, evangelical Caribbean family. I've come a long, long, long way relative to the LGBT issue. And it's crazy. My mother was not really homophobic. I mean, I remember when I first came to this country, like, she explained gay people to us. And it didn't compute because, you know, I didn't understand sex and sexuality. You know, I was like four or five, mm-hmm. 5, 6 years old. I didn't get it. And, but she basically said, a lot of people are bad to those people, but we're not going to be like that, but they're not following God's commands. And that's all I remember. My mother was never, she, my mother was, I love her, but racist as hell. I was talking to one of my buddies yesterday. He's like, you're racist as hell. And I was like, yeah. Like, I don't think I am, but, like, knowing who I am and knowing how much I love my mom, I'm certain that there is, you know. But she was never with the gay stuff, which is probably another reason why I've been able to, you know, whatever. But, yeah, I was, interesting. Right there where, yeah, so, like, people are making fun of the way he runs and all that shit, like, you know, it was tough. But then the end of the song, we're I got too many pages.
He says, up. I'm like Fred Astaire.
Yeah, so I wanna like that last part right there is yeah. what I wanna talk about yeah. because it's this was brilliant songwriting. Look what he says. He says, I'm like Stone Cold Steve Austin. Oh, no, I put homophobes in coffins.
This is Fred Astaire.
Right. I'm like Stone Cold Steve Austin, I put homophobes in coffins. Mm-hmm. Stone Cold Steve Austin is like he's a wrestler, mm-hmm. and as far as like charisma, because charisma is a stat in wrestling, he's probably, from what I saw from Stone Cold when Stone Cold was in his heyday, he had even more charisma than Hulk Hogan. Like,
oh,
and
did?
That's saying a lot. Stone Cold in the late 90s.
I did see a ton of T-shirts with that guy.
Trumps Hulk Hogan in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason is that Hulk Hogan, he was just the traditional hero. He would tell you to do your push-ups, say your prayers, eat your vitamins at night, and then wake up and have a good day. So, like, my brother, like, Hulkamania, brother, and he would talk about, like, and he would say, you know, pray, do all, he was out there fucking bitches doing all types of shit, you know, but he had this, like, almost, like, godlike, you know, whereas Stone Cold was like, man, fuck all that shit, bro. Like, I'm going to drink a beer, and I'm going to tell the boss, fuck you. I'm going to give the boss the finger. Like, Stone Cold is peak toxic masculinity.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, like just angry all the time and unable to be reasoned with, extremely violent. Look what he says. I'm Stone Cold Steve Austin. I put homophobes in coffins. Like, again, that's that, that contradiction within himself, where on the one hand he's like peak toxic masculinity and he's bragging about it, but then he's saying, I'm going to apply my toxic violent streak towards people that are homophobic. I'm like Fred Astaire. I dance like I don't care, which is again a contradiction, because Fred Astaire is this, you know, he's dancy, he's footloose, he's, you know, all this. And but he's saying, I dance like I don't care. He's like, yeah, I could be Stone Cold Steve Austin and
I can dance like I don't
care. I am Fred Astaire. So I'm like Ted DiBiase. I win no matter what it costs me. Ted DiBiase is another wrestler who's called the Million Dollar Man. And his whole thing was like, his character was like this Machiavellian guy who would do anything for money. And he was a millionaire, and he didn't play by the rules. And this was like in the 80s when you're supposed to play by the rules. Like they had this, you know, but Ted DiBiase was sort of this Machiavellian type guy. Man, fuck all that, bro. I just want to make money and that type of thing. He also had a black slave named Virgil that used to walk around with him all the time. It's pretty ridiculous. I'm like Evil Knievel. I break my bones for my people. Evil Knievel is a stunt driver, and he broke like probably every bone in his body. I break my bones for my people. I'm on my best behavior, like Jesus Christ our Savior. I'm like Reggie Cray. Reggie Cray was a gangster in London. He was they were twin brothers. There's actually a movie about it. We should probably watch it. I'm not gonna talk a lot about that, because we might see it and it might give away a big spoiler. But so he's dealing with all the contradictions within himself. I really, really enjoyed this song. He did such a good job with the song, and it was very weird the way that it worked. Like the build up. I've never really seen a song like
then
that.
They stopped. If the drummer wouldn't have been standing there like this, I would have had no clue there was something else coming.
Like, and then they completely shifted the energy of the song to the second half of the song. They did a really, really good job. I've never heard a song like this before. This is kind of probably one of the most unique songs I've heard this year that worked. I've heard a lot of songs this year that were unique, but they didn't work. This one I felt like worked. It went a bunch of different directions.
This one
I really enjoyed it.
Unique, but it was unique both in what it sounded like and visually what it looked like.
Yeah.
And then also unique in the lyrics, like the way that he was, the contradiction that that is himself. If I don't know any context and I don't really know like what's going on, like the style of it, you know, for me was like kind of like a 5. But then I'm going to give him points because the lyrics, the honesty, I guess the self-realization and being able to come out with that. And also, I really appreciate people just kind of putting their weirdness out there. I don't know if that's the right word. Just like, I like that. I like it when people are brave enough to be able to do that. And I don't know, like, sometimes I wonder, like, if everybody is secretly weird, and some people are just better at hiding it, or if, like, some people are just like, I'm a lot more weird than you know. Like, I just, like, when I'm alone, like, I do, like, just weird dumbness, like dancing and saying voices, or, like, trying different voices and stuff. Why is that making you, that makes you feel weird?
No, I just want you to stop right there.
So, I don't
just
know.
Want you to quit.
You don't look like you're weird like that. Like, you don't, and I never see that side of you. So, but then I wonder, like, are you like that too? Like, are you kind of weird too when you're by yourself?
When am I ever by myself?
Just when you're in the shower.
And you text me and say, okay, can I come in? I'm like, holy shit.
I just needed to get something.
All day with you.
I just needed to get something.
I said, no. I need time away from you,
I need a break from you. I was like, I wasn't even going
to
talk to you.
And 10 minutes later, I was out of the shower. And that happened 2 days ago. She's still talking about that shit. Rate the song.
I didn't bring that up. You did.
Rate the song.
7.2.
All right, this is a 9.2. You're on crack to give it a 7. This was excellent. It was an excellent song. Okay, guys, we have just begun the day for the Big Homie Game. Shout out to the Big Homie Game.
Red Fang is up next.
9.2. Red Fang is next, dear listener. Let's talk about it. Vin out.
Sorry, out.
Gone. No, bro. She will not give me even 5 minutes, son. I was sitting there, like, enjoying the heat. You know when you, like, challenge the shower?
You should
like,
ask him how long he was like, already in there for. All right,
bitch, come on. Give me some shit. Come on. I can take it. I was sitting there enjoying that, doing the good jihad with the hot water. There's the beep. Boop, 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 boop. Can I come in? And I said, wait, what?
It's going to be literally
I said, no. What would M. Death fans say in this situation? And I said, no, bitch! I want my time! I'm standing up as a man!
I need a break from you.
All right!
Fine, take your break. I just needed to get something.
Commercial break, we're on the way! I'm Ben.
I'm sorry.
If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It's sorry says... 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the lines. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes!
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insori@gmail.com and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we can't guarantee a positive review. Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is a community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Shh, message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. What? Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go in the village, facebook.com/VinandSori. There's 160 plus thousand people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community, connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Buy our merch indeed.
The child shall lead them.
To buy our merch.
Yes, dear listener. Right. Yes, dear listener. Yes, dear listener. Talk to him. Talk to him, Sister Minister.
Are in the midst of a DJ Gabe stream.
Huh? That's not coming off? Are they
here?
I'm
hearing something playing over here.
Okay, go ahead.
I don't know if everybody can hear it or not. Okay, so we have DJ Gabe up on the docket tonight.
Yes,
and
sir-y
the next
Bobber.
Song
yes,
is
sir-y
by
Bobber.
A band called Red Fang. The name of the song is Prehistoric Dog. He said, this is an official video. This band and label is extremely unlikely to block and even less likely to strike. But if you don't want to risk it, watch the video off screen and link the video for chat to watch along. The video itself is worth a watch. Certainly a band with a sense of humor. Okay, so I have the official video.
On the side.
Yep, it's on the side. And I am going to take the link right now and post it for the stream. Boop.
Go ahead.
And then, I'm just not sure maybe if you should actually post that link because your stream lab thing or whatever goes to everybody. But here we go. Here's the link.
Okay, the name of this band is Red Fang. The name of the song is...
Prehistoric Dog.
Prehistoric Dog. You know what, though? You know what?
Oh boy.
That's how the British people say, you know what?
You know what?
I mean, we've already been banned. So, we've already been blocked.
So you're doing it?
So, what's the harm if we've already been blocked? I'm already going to have to send that off to YouTube.
All right.
Have they responded about my disputes yet, by the way?
Because when I looked earlier, it was still blocked.
Talk to the people. I got to take care of something real quick.
Okay. So you guys, thanks for helping out the homie earlier.
I think I might have. Yeah, we got it.
Oh, it's unblocked now?
Well, we got the second one unblocked.
Oh, I didn't know the second one was blocked in the first place.
Okay, talk to the people.
I'm also blocking
the sabotage thing. Shit, it's still
I'm
blocked.
I'm blocking the nasty right now.
Song one is still blocked. Okay. Okay. Red Fang, Prehistoric Dog. We're going to go with the actual official music video, guys. We're going to go with the official video because, like I said, when you are the DJ, we do our damnedest to get it exactly like the way that you want it. Again, because we don't cut up the song in the middle like most reaction channels, this is what happens. That doesn't mean the other react channels are bad or that we're better than them or anything like that. It's just the way that we do it, okay? And so because of that, like, share, comment, subscribe, other reactors, by the way. But because of that, sometimes we get blocked. We may get blocked this time, but this is for the big homie, so we gotta do it. Here All we right. go. Who takes the phone in the shower, freak? How do you think I know all my stuff that I can quote these people and these scientists and the rest of it? I gotta have some time. I gotta strategize ways to get by alone when I'm completely lucid so I can hear this these amazing theories from these scientists. Stop interrupting me! It is time, dear listener, for Prehistoric Dog. Here's the official music video.
Let's
Red
go.
Thing. Gabe in the house. Let's do this shit.
One, two, three, go.
Is that beer?
Yep.
Lost as Australian from the beer.
Disgusting.
Paul.
Call me Gorg.
Okay, Gorg, look, it's not about the hit points right now. I'm just trying to work on my swordsmanship.
Fireball. Totally OC, dude.
Sorry, look, this chainmail doesn't cover all of me. I have emotions still.
Hey!
My gosh!
Gandalf, nice dress.
LARP.
Mm-hmm.
laughing.
One of them hit him with the bolt that he did the Gandalf shit and taking him out of there. We're back. Okay. All right. So there we go. We have discovered what LARPing is. LARPing is a live-action roleplay. But you know, like, I guess we're supposed to make fun of LARPers, but how is that different from, like, Civil War reenactment?
I don't know.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I mean...
Like, they dress up like the Union and the Confederacy, and then they go at it, and they get shot, they die, all types of shit. I actually knew a guy in Maine that was, like... He was on a shit, and of course he was a Confederate. He was fighting for the Confederate. He was explaining to me it wasn't about slavery and shit. I was fine. I was like, I was more interested in. But wait a second, he had an entire picture. Him and his boys. You remember that Ford over there in Augusta?
Mm-hmm.
When I drive you around, yeah. Him and his boys doing all that shit, muskets and all that. Like, I don't really see what the difference is between that and.
I mean. Is there a difference?
There's no difference. You know what I'm saying? But, like, they're LARPers, but I guess we're just going to make fun of the D&D kids and shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, when the D&D kids do it, they're let's make fun of them. But these Civil War and reenactors, like, there's entire, like,
things
where you go watch people read. Same thing with medieval times. Like, it's the same shit, but I don't know.
Well, different. Maybe it has to do with, you know, the amateur looking side of it. I don't know.
Well, and look, I'm not like gonna be over serious about it. I mean, it's kind of funny and weird and stuff like that. Like, I get it, but sometimes when you're not introduced to a concept and it's a new concept, you start seeing holes that other people don't see. You know what I'm saying? It's like kids. Yeah. But especially now that we're studying Jung and things like that with active imagination.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not, you know, it's so, like, there's so many things that has changed in my mind about a lot of things from reading that one book, that Active Imagination. You should probably read it start to finish.
Yeah.
Or listen to it. It's not long. It's only like a 5-hour read. You know what I'm saying? Like, but it takes concepts like imagination and... It the book doesn't go that far, but it comes pretty damn close to almost assigning ontology to your imaginations. And there is something that's going on with the Civil War reenactors. Like, there's something happening. I don't mean like they're mentally ill. No, I'm saying in the opposite direction. Like, there's some sort of conscientious psychological connection with everything that I also so now. Games like D&D, where it's mostly based on your imagination, right? So, like, there's concepts.
Negative Vibe said you should sit on one of the village D&D nights sometime.
I'm really, really, really not against that. I'm very, very fascinated by that.
Saying that?
Maida puts it up, you know, that's my gut. But, like, I almost, like, want to sit on one of those things, but I don't want to act like I'm, like, at a petting zoo, you know what I'm saying? So I didn't know how to, like, broach the subject, like, yo, bro, can I, like,
watch... Oh, well, you got an invite,
Can I, like, watch some of that shit? Like, see... You know what I'm saying? But now, like, I would be looking at it from, like, a completely Jungian perspective, and it's different.
Yeah, for sure.
Delaney, I would LARP, no cap. I can't tell you how much I love these young people, bro. No cap! Okay, so let's actually talk about the song itself. Dogs that howl from outer space come to Earth to lay to waste. With fang and claw to shred your face, they will erase the human race. Okay, these guys are rhyming. Like, if you put a hip-hop beat, dogs.
Yeah.
If I go with, like, an 80s style hip-hop.
Yeah.
Dogs that howl from outer space come to Earth to lay to waste. With fang and claw to shred your face, they will erase the human race.
Yep.
That's how they used to rap. That's how they used to rap back in the day. Prehistoric dog, time to kiss your ass goodbye. Prehistoric dogs of war, pack of wolves is at your door. Their will to kill, to fill the pits of hell. Blood is spilled and none too soon, looking down from a cratered moon.
They see us flee. We need to break the spell. Dogs that howl from outer space come to Earth to lay the waste with Thing and Claw and shred your face. They will erase the human race. Time to kiss your ass goodbye. Our lives are long, but our flesh is gone. It may be wrong. God bless godlessness. We're walking tall. If we walk at all, we're living like a prehistoric dog. This guy, I'm almost a little bit mad at. This lyricist. Because he is so good. If you look at the second half of that, it may be wrong, but God bless godlessness.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good line. That's a really, really good line. And I feel like this was kind of like a tongue-in-cheek song. So I want to hear more from this band. Because this guy, even though it's like a funny song, you could tell it was a funny song. But this guy can write. I can tell that this dude can legitimately write. But I agree. I mean, it's funny what he said, and a lot of it is the video. Like, I'm glad that we saw the video. What was cool was this one didn't get blocked, so that's good. Go ahead.
Yeah,
what
I'm
were
surprised.
Saying?
So the video, again, Gabe, he's bringing us all this kind of odd stuff, you know, like the guy's beginning burping. It was like, you know what I mean? Like, then you're seeing all of them going out in the field and stuff. I find that stuff entertaining. Did you notice a floor during the scenes? Like, sometimes they were, like, covered in cans and sometimes they were clean.
Yeah, the beer. Well, the other thing that surprised me... First of all, that Four Horsemen beat, it kind of especially, like, the to the lower end, the last third of the song, it sounded like that... That Four Horsemen beat, which is a classic one. No, you did not miss Pearl Jam. But... I was surprised at the musicianship because I thought it was going to be all goofy, but those guys can legitimately...
Yeah, and they can sing, too.
Right.
I was like, what? When the singing started,
yeah.
I was genuinely shocked because...
Don't judge a book by its cover.
Yeah, they just, you know, it just looked like such a giant joke at the beginning. And so I thought it was just going to kind of be like odd-sounding music, but then their vocal style was really good. I was like, wait.
Yeah.
That always makes really me, good. Like, wonder if... Because... You know, there's, like, been some bands that we've seen that, like, this is one of them, where I'm like, I wonder if they, like, made a really serious song. Like, where could they go with it?
Right. That's what I'm saying. Like, I want to hear more from this band because, like, I like when the band has a sense of humor. But this guy can really, really, truly write.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, if he wanted to say something serious, like, I'd want to know, like... What's in his head? Like,
so what?
What's important to him?
What is this song about?
I just think it's just a made up story. You know, it's about the dogs of war from outer space, and you know, I think they just wanted to write a ridiculous song and have a ridiculous show. But some of the stuff that he said though is, I really like that God bless godlessness line. Just not only because of the irony of but the way that the English language works and how hard that is to say God bless godlessness. It's like Cellar Door or Seneca Truth or something like that. It just flows from your flows. It flows.
I see.
Okay, so I'm gonna judge this song based on what they were trying to do. They weren't trying to be too serious. They were trying to have fun. At the same time, it was a badass song. So I really, really liked it. So I'm gonna rate it. So I'm gonna put this in like the Weird Al type genre. This song. I'm not saying this band. But I'm saying this song. I'm gonna put in like the Weird Al, Tenacious D.
Okay.
We're funny.
Yep.
But we're still talented genre. And because of that, I'm gonna give this as well a 9.1. 9.1 for me. What'd you give
8.7.
Why did you react like that? You said that the guy, like...
Was very surprised to hear it in the 90s.
What do you mean? Like, he took you off guard with
his musicianship
and with his vocals.
He did.
So, how are they not getting credit for that?
They are. I gave him... What did I just give it? I gave it an 8.7?
8.7 is not enough. Not enough.
A 5 is just... This is regular. 8.7 is...
Yeah,
that's
a
decent score.
I guess.
Tenacious D is up next.
Sean the non-believer. Sean!
Oh, my gosh.
Nobody knows where that's from. Sean the non-believer.
Okay, okay, we're coming right back, dear listener, with more metal. What's the next song?
Tenacious D.
Tenacious D. Okay, so this brother's got a little bit of
a little quirky
side. A funny bone in him. That's a funny bone in him. We will take you guys on the other side of the break. Vid out.
Sorry out.
Go. That guy was funny. Huh?
Yes.
I like when people bring funny bands. It's funny. All right, guys, commercial break. No, that guy was. I'm Vin.
I'm sorry.
If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It's sorry says 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the alliance. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes!
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insori@gmail.com and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we can't guarantee a positive review. Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is the community option. $1 at the gate gets you into Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Shh, message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. What? Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah, yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go in the village, facebook.com/VinandSori. There's 160 plus thousand people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Buy our merch indeed, and Chelle shall lead them.
To buy our merch.
Yes, dear listener. Yes, dear listener. Yes, dear all listener. All right.
Tenacious D, City Hall. Long live the D, says our...
I agree. May O.D. live as long as possible. And B. Okay, go ahead.
There are two sort of hidden tracks here following City Hall. One is a short skit that immediately follows the song called I Believe. Then there's about a minute of dead air before a short song, Malibu Nights, that runs to the completion of the runtime. Okay, so... So I guess we're doing, but we're doing the, we're doing City Hall. City Hall is the song that he's chosen.
All right. City Hall is the chosen song. Here we go. City Hall, Tenacious D. If you, dear listener, would like to get yourself a DJ stream as well, the process is very simple. It's a 4-song minimum, and we do our absolute damnedest to get it to you exactly your way. So here we go. Tenacious D, City Hall. Let's do this shit. Go!
All you people up there in City Hall, you're fucking it up for the people that's in the streets. This is a song for the people in the streets and the people City Hall. All you motherfuckers in the streets, time to rise up, come along children and fucking rise. Lots of times when me and Genji are watching all the fucking shit that goes down in City Hall, we get the feeling we should fuck shit up. Yeah, we should fucking start a riot. Tipping over shit and breaking fucking windows of small businesses and setting fucking fires and setting fucking fires and setting fucking fires.
It's like a punk song.
And then after
the smoke has cleared and the rubble has been swept away, me and KG will peek out our heads.
Definitely see the Beatles.
We've been watching the riots on a monitor 20 floors below sea level from a bunker. We did it, Rage Cage. We beat the bastards of City Hall! But now what will we do? We must rebuild. But who will lead us in the rebuilding process? Man, it's got to be someone with the know-how and the elbow grease to lead us to a new life. No, not me and KG. We don't have the cognitive capacity to lead. All right, we'll do it. We'll lead us to Kings. We'll lead us to Kings. We'll lead us to Kings. The first decree is to legalize marijuana. The tyranny and the bullshit's gone on too long. You old Amen. Fucking shrimps who blocked its legalization. You're banished from the land!
Get the fuck
we'll out! Lead us to Kings! We'll lead us to Kings! Lead us to Kings! The second decree! No more pollution. No more car exhaust. Or ocean dumpage.
Amen.
From now on, we will travel in two. We'll lead it to King. Yeah. We'll fucking lead us to King.
Yeah, he's laughing at that shit.
Get the scientists working on the tube technology immediately. Chapter two. Third decree. No more rich people and poor people. From now on, we will all be the same. I don't know, I gotta think about that one. Lead us to Kings! Oh my god.
What?
Dude, the red phone is flashing.
Oh yeah.
Let me scoop that up. Hello? Two Kings.
Who is it?
What? No! No fucking way!
What?
Reach, there's a potato famine in Idaho. You gotta go down there.
Oh my god. What?
Dude,
what?
I gotta stay here.
Why do I have to
please,
go?
Please,
okay.
Awesome. Hi. Is he gone? All right. Emergency meeting of
potato
Parliament.
Potato famine in Idaho.
All right, Parliament. I know this is fucked up, but Rage, he can't be king anymore. Dudes, he's encroaching on my decrees. Seriously, let's make him duke. A kick-ass duke. Or leader formerly known as king, but oh, my he's coming back. We'll lead us to king. Oh, yes, we'll really lead us to king.
Dude,
Rage.
I went all over Idaho.
Yeah?
Plenty of potatoes
what?
Everywhere.
There's yeah, no
there's
famine.
No famine, no.
Dude.
I don't know what's a...
A toast.
A toast.
Long live the D.
Long live the D.
Long live me. I'm sorry. I poisoned your wine. For the good of the land.
I poisoned yours as well.
No! No!
City Hall, 'cause no one here is talking. People inside.
Don't cut that part out.
Don't cut that part.
We lose the two kings.
We've got it.
Do you believe in God?
I believe.
You do?
I believe in God. Oh, I believe in God.
You do?
Oh, I believe in God.
Okay.
Do you?
I believe in God.
Can you skip the quiet minute?
I got some lyrics.
Malibu nights, tangerine dreams, Malibu knees, Malibu dreams, Malibu, making a pool, stinky pool, looking at you, because it's time for my breakfast, it's time for some cheese. For the stink, time for the breeze, time for the hurry.
Okay.
That's the end of the song?
That's the end.
Have we finally completed it, inshallah? Okay, we could be kings!
I like this one. Okay, is this... I'm remembering this correctly, right? Kung Fu Panda is the guy that sings this?
That's Jack Black.
Right.
I don't know if... yeah, that's
gotta
be
it, look,
right? Oh, yeah,
look, zoom in. There they are.
Yeah, that's...
okay.
It's Kung Fu Panda.
Yeah, he's so funny because he's just another one of those characters where I'm like, I wish you'd put out a serious song because I feel like you got some real talent
that's
here.
That's what I'm saying. Like, but he's a badass. That's what I'm saying.
But you know what? At the same time, like, maybe he doesn't want to. Maybe he just likes this. You know what I'm saying? Like, maybe he likes to
really? Put,
maybe he likes to be funny. And that's part of how he likes to do his music. I can appreciate that. So, he, you know, obviously the storyline starts out, they're at City Hall, they're making a real mess of everything, and so then there's riots in the street. Well, him and his homeboy are hanging out, like, deep under the water, watching everything just burn to the ground in an underground
that's
bunker.
That's what I'm saying. Like, why are they underwater? That's my question.
20 floors below sea level from a bunker. Okay, so I didn't Rage Cage is the name of his friend, I guess.
Yeah.
We did it, Rage Cage. We beat the bastards of City Hall. But then it turns out, you know, they're like, yeah, we're doing this together. They come up with a couple of different ideas. One being legalizing marijuana. The other one, okay, so this is funny when he's like, the second decree, no more pollution, no more car exhaust or ocean dumpage. From now on, we'll travel in tubes. That to me reminded me of, you know, when you go to the bank and you send your money through that tube?
Yeah.
Well, I've thought before, I wonder if there's a way that human beings could travel like that where it would be like really fast and you could just, and it wouldn't like, of course I was a child when I was thinking this. It was around the time I was watching the Jetsons.
Okay.
So it was just funny to hear him say...
I remember thinking that that was like the pinnacle of technology, though. Because when I first came to this country, I was
the bank?
Like, holy... Oh, that little tube thingy that
yeah.
they that put... Poor Delaney. Delaney has no idea what the fuck we're talking about.
Oh, about they
she's
still
never,
have them
never,
now.
Yeah, she's... Why?
They have them at Camden when I go there.
When would you even use that?
They have two drive-ups. Oh, I've driven up.
And
money
used
out.
It?
Yeah.
Instead of the ATM?
Yeah.
Why would you do that?
Well, sometimes if you need cash back, but you don't want it in just 20s.
Okay.
So before I know what it was. Before I got the kids their green light cards, which is, you know, we don't have a sponsorship there, but it's a really cool app. And you can get each of your kids a card, and you're able to, like, pay
say,
them
why
their...
Are you, why are you giving these bitches free ads?
They're able to pay it. Their... You pay them their allowance straight from there. It's very convenient. And then they have a card. It has their little picture on it. And then anytime they make a purchase, you know exactly what they're buying.
Yep. It's a good way... It's a good way for astute teenagers to rock their parents to sleep.
It's not about that. It's just I get curious to know what they're doing.
No, I know. But, like, if I was a kid, I'd know exactly how I'd do that.
What would you do?
Well, I'd have one card that's like that, then I'd have a completely separate card that doesn't do that at all. So you think you're in autopilot, and meanwhile I've got all this stuff going on the other side.
We have one kid that has two cards.
I know.
Anyway, so yeah, when I go there, before I had those cards though, I always had to go keep taking the money out manually and giving everybody cash for their allowance. It was a friggin' hassle. And so I'm like, I need some dollars and some fines.
This song is really funny and it's really serious. But there's some stuff in here that's really hilarious to me because of how true it is.
Rich people and poor people think?
Well, first of all, they sound, no disrespect, but they sound a little bit like, you know, like when AOC was first talking about the Green New Deal and all that good stuff. Mm-hmm. And it was very, you know, she presented, and you know, AOC is, I mean, she's young, you know, she's part of our crew, but it was very childish, like, oh, we're going to have this, and we're going to have that, and everybody's going to be happy, and all these, like, oversimplistic solutions to the climate problem, and it was full of all this hope and you know, just wild-eyed, bushy-tailed, you know,
yeah,
ideas that are very hopeful, but don't really take into account the real world.
We're all like that. Like, think about whenever everybody's a kid, they have all these opinions about what adults should be like.
But AOC's a grown woman. That's my problem.
Like, she hadn't been there yet. Once she got there, then she's like, wait, this is different.
I'm not dissing AOC. I'm just saying, like, that's what happens when you're, you know, it's got, but this song was written, like, in 2001.
2001,
so,
yeah.
So they were kind of like, they're almost making fun of that ideology. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like it was kind of like a joke the way that they were saying it, but at the same time, it's kind of true the way those folks think. You know what I'm saying? Like that's how they think. And I'm glad they think that way. Like, we need idealistic people. It's just they end up getting crushed, you know what I'm saying, under the weight of quote reality, because you know, it's very hard to accomplish all that stuff. It really is.
Absolutely.
So, like, I got a lot of respect for AOC relative to, you know, what she's trying to accomplish. But the way that they did it, it just reminded me of her because I'm like, yo, this is pretty much, you know, how a lot. And honestly, it was how a lot of Bernie Sanders supporters were as well, like their mind state. And it's tough because they got a rude awakening in 2016. Like, yo, this is not how this shit works. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And so on the one hand, like, it's funny to, like, listen to this and the way they're talking and stuff. But on the other hand, it's like, damn, you know, like, you know, we're trying to do something here significant where everybody could be happy or everybody has healthcare. And then you just quickly realize, like, this shit is not going to be as simple as you think it is. Mm-hmm. Because when you first hear it, you hear things like Medicare for All or taking care of the environment. It sounds so intuitive. It's like, oh, yeah, of course. But, like, implementing it is a completely different story. But there were a couple other things in there, too, that was, like, really hilarious to me. Like, where is it? Okay. All you people up there in City Hall, you're fucking it up for the people that's in the streets. This is a song for people in the streets, not the people in City Hall. All you motherfuckers in the streets, it's time to rise up. Come along, children, and fucking rise. This is September 25th, 2001. Mm-hmm. So that means most likely that the song was written well before 9/11.
What year was 9/11?
2001. September 11th, 2001. Okay. So the song was released 25 September, but it was most likely written like a year or two prior to that. So you're saying things like "hit the streets, riot." You could never say, Well, Tenacious D would never make a song like that now, because if you say riot and all that stuff now, like, people will riot and they will blame you for what happens afterwards. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, like, it was just funny to me, and it's almost a little bit sad. Like, that's how boring life was in America, or nothing was really on the line. That's how insulated we were as Americans. It's like you could make songs about rioting and all types of shit, and it would just be a big joke because we weren't really going to riot. We had nothing to riot about.
Oh. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Especially like we were coming off the Clinton administration, which feel how you want to feel about Clinton, but the economy was in really good shape, bro. Really good shape. Friends had taken off. Starbucks had taken off. Like, that's what Americans cared about at the time. And then 9/11 happened, and the paradigm completely changed. But
wow.
It's just kind of like, that was kind of like really on the line of the, you know, before America lost her innocence, say it that way, which is a ridiculous thing to say because we had Vietnam, we had, you know, from the beginning of the inception of this country. But I still feel like we lost something that we'll never get back after 9/11, obviously.
Well, I think that, yeah, we had Vietnam, but not, we didn't all experience that. Like, 9/11 was something that we all experienced, all of us regular folks that didn't really know what everything was going on. And it was the first time that something, an invasion had happened on our soil. And I think that it scared a lot of people. It changed a lot of people. And it was temporarily, actually, I think, the zeitgeist was so wonderful at first. And, I mean, eventually that changed and then it took a completely different turn. But I did like after 9/11 how close-knit people were.
Like, look right here. We have them screaming in the streets. We have them tipping over shit and breaking fucking windows of small businesses. Mm-hmm. Like, that was funny back then. You know what I'm saying? Like,
okay.
That was funny. That's not funny anymore. Like, breaking windows of small businesses, that's not funny anymore. Because that shit really did happen to people, especially during the whole George Floyd uprising. Like, shit was, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, again, like, it just reflected a time when, you know, and I just think about Delaney. Delaney wasn't even born when 9/11 happened. That's, like, mind-boggling to me. Like, yo, she wasn't even born, son. Like, that shit was crazy. She was almost born, like, 10 years after 9/11. Shit is weird to me.
That's crazy.
But, like, if you look at it, he's saying, like, we could destroy all these small businesses or whatever. And it was funny. We're setting fucking fires. It's funny. And then when the smoke cleared and the rubble's been swept away, me and KG will poke out our heads and we'll be watching the riots on a monitor 20 floors below sea level. And then he's talking about the bastard of City Hall and rebuilding and all the rest of it. But there was, we'll lead as two kings, right? The first decree is to legalize marijuana. The tyranny and the bullshit's gone on too long. Which is funny, because again, like, when you first hear, I'm sure when people first heard that, people were like, there's no way they're going to legalize marijuana. Come on, ridiculous. And now here we are. So it's just so weird how the country is, like, flipped since this song. Like,
yeah.
You can joke about, like, destroying small businesses. Like, that's a joke. But now it's the real world. And then they were joking about, like, legalizing marijuana, which is, like, this impossible thing. And now it's, like, the real world. Like, it's just weird how time changes and how, you know, you think the world is one way, but it's not. And here it is, the second degree. No pollution, no more car exhaust or ocean dumpage. From now on, we'll travel in tubes. Which is, again, like, it's making fun of, like, this almost, like, childish, like, oh, really? You're going to get rid of all the emissions? Oh, really? So everybody's just going to travel in a tube? You know what I'm saying? Like, I forget. AOC said something about cows and cows farting or something. Like, we need to reduce the amount of meat we eat because the cows are farting and it's like the methane is fucking. And like, dead ass serious. Like, she was dead ass serious. So, like, it got to be like.
Talk about straining at a gnat.
It just got to be really, you know, like the Green New Deal stuff. And you know, some of it passed or whatever, Kristen Sinema, but I don't know. And then the last thing about it, was when he said, and nobody will be rich. And then Jack Black was like, well, wait a second. I don't know about that. And then notice.
I need to think about that.
Yeah. Notice, like, they couldn't get along. And they had to split, which is basically the story of, like, socialism/communism. It's like, oh, we're going to do this. It's going to be great. We're going to just simplify everything, and nobody's going to be rich, and all this, and then everybody's going to give peace a chance, because City Hall is the problem. We're not the problem. City Hall is the problem. And then it turns out that they end up poisoning each other because their sinful nature is taking over, and they wanted to be the rulers, but then they end up poisoning each other. It was really, it's really, really good comedy, but it's really saying a lot about human nature, and I don't know if that was the point. About that, like meat consumption, there it is. Meat consumption is a huge part of carbon emissions. That's the point. Yeah, I mean, I guess it's just, you know, we've got canine. God gave us canines, or evolution gave you canines for a reason. So, I understand.
I mean, there might be a problem with that. Like,
I understand cattle is an argument. I understand, but that's
there
never
are bigger
gonna,
issues.
That's never. Well, it's not that there are bigger cows. Issues to me. It's just it's never going to happen. You're never going to be in a situation where people are not eating meat, especially Americans. Like that, along with slavery and land acquirership, has been one of the hallmarks. Honestly, meat and potatoes. Honestly. If you look at the ancient world, like having meat all the time was not, it was special occasions. So like, I agree, but part of the, theoretically speaking, part of the reasons that America has a superior position, I mean, a bunch of other historical accidents, I mean that in philosophical sense, is our diet, especially at the beginning, because it promoted a lot of agricultural supremacy. Because again, even if you were a farmer back in the day, you weren't eating steak every day. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So I understand like the whole meat thing, blah, blah, blah. But that is never, ever going to happen. You're not going to separate Americans from their beef. We invented McDonald's. We invented Burger King. That shit is never going to happen, bro. So like, you know, I get it. I understand. Like, I mean, honestly, I would really need to see a lot of hard data about what these people are saying about me. There was one documentary, Joe Rogan interviewed those guys, and they were, you know, really extreme with it. And it turns out, like, half the shit they said in the documentary was debunked. But, yeah, we could watch it. I mean, that's basically the idea. But it's a funny song, but it's interesting commentary on America and human nature in general. I really, really like the song. This is another 9.4 for me. Well, actually, it's a 9.7 because it gave me genuine belly laughs. Like, I really... Some of the shit that they were saying was really terrible, like, to laugh at. But anyway, 9.7. What'd you give it?
9.7 as well.
There you are, dear listener! We've got more songs on the way. There's a band called King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard. I don't know if you guys ever heard of that, but they're up next. Check
Work
it out.
This time.
Vin out.
Story out.
Go! Okay, we shall return! That was such a funny song. I'm Ben.
I'm sorry.
If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. As Sori says, 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of Alliance. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes.
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insori@gmail.com and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we
can't guarantee a positive review.
Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is a community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft, Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah, yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go on the village, facebook.com/VinandSori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Buy our merch indeed. A child shall lead them.
To buy our merch.
All we're waiting on is our studio engineer to call us back. All you patient people that have been on Patreon listening, waiting and waiting and waiting for the Vinny and Sori debut.
Fear not! As soon as our engineer jumps on, we will be good to go. But you guys don't care about that right now. What you care about is King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard, brought to you by the big homie Gabe. You see that right there? That's Gabe.
The name of the song is Work This Time. Our DJ says, my streams aren't complete without at least one of these low-resolution videos, right?
This is the real.
In this case, a cell phone video.
Talk shit,
let's
go.
I love when lead guitarist Joey gets a chance to sing, and it's hilarious to me to see him rip that solo at the end wearing those shorts. Gabe, you're a funny person.
That's what I'm saying. Like, the dude, it's a relief, because I went in on my Middle America stuff. I went really in. The song is coming soon. Yeah, it is. I called the studio engineer today, actually.
Did you get a hold of him?
No. Yeah. He was on vacation, but he should be off of his vacation soon.
Yeah.
I wanna be able to play it to the homie. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. That'll be good. That'll be a good moment. Okay, guys, here we go.
Oh, I see. Okay, yeah, let's go. You're
all
cute.
Right, King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard. Let's go. It's a surprisingly clear video, though.
Yeah, turn it so I can
see. I got you.
He's gonna rip it in those shorts.
He really is in shorts.
But I'm going to dedicate it to my partner in crime, my partner Edith, her name is, and she's actually here tonight. So, let's go on stage,
come on. She's running away. Come back here, please. There you are. There you go. You know what? I don't know how they could play still plugged in. I'd have to get one of those, Wi-Fi like receiver things. Cause I'd be afraid I'd get my wires all, you know, unplugged. I'm in the middle of rocking out and my wires all off.
Maybe the cord is more secure as far as making sure your sound doesn't cut out. More secure than it did before.
More secure. Or is this just more, I'm just going to make shit up on the fly?
I said maybe. I legit said maybe, bitch.
All right, here we go.
Thank you.
from a cell phone. Man.
Yeah, that was still pretty clear.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Like, for that to be on a cell phone, the guitar quality. Like, some of it is like, you know, having the money to have a really good, legitimate, like, sound system. But some of it is just being really proficient at your craft. Like, I know, like, more that I'm playing, the more, like, I'm like, oh, that chord, that string, ah! Like, you want it perfect. You want all the notes perfect. You want them to ring out perfect, and it's if your technique is off, I'll tell you what, one thing I learned about guitar, if your technique is off, it duplicates and triplicates your work. You know, like you've got to have the good foundation of some really, really good technique, otherwise you're going to end up paying the price like I've had to, and then you spend your waking hours at 4 or 5 in the morning trying to correct a scale that you thought you've had for years and
oh, seriously, babe?
Has been wrong.
How did you know it was wrong?
Because when I look at, when I first saw it was wrong, because I recognized the progression in a Neil song, and then I was like, oh, I forgot the name of it. The only one I remember is Dorian Mode for obvious reason, but like, you go and look and you're like, holy shit, I got that whole thing, but like, your technique is so important, especially when you're playing live. Like, in the studio, you know, you can make people make you sound good, but it's not like that in a live show. And obviously, LEM's point is good. Phones are pretty good for bootlegs these days. That is true. I bought I think it was a Fear Factory bootleg at Old Orchard Beach, actually. And it was horrible. But I loved it because you know how I am with live music.
Yeah.
Like, technology is so
ridiculous. What
is a bootleg?
Is that like, it's a, like a, basically a cut CD that's just, I don't know what that is.
No, it was somebody took a camera to the show and recorded it.
Okay.
Like a physical camera and then recorded the show and then they would sell it. Hey, you can see Fear Factory live. This was before YouTube. You know, so Delaney's like, why would anybody buy that? Like, yeah. this is before YouTube, so if you wanted that, you need to see Fear Factory.
Yeah.
And it was something that you know that nobody else had, because this specific guy had it. So, so that was bootleg before, but now it's so much more. Somebody just did Woodstock, and they remastered it up to 4K, and it's unbelievable.
Really?
I watched Korn's entire set again today. Because of the Netflix thing.
Mm-hmm.
I had no idea how emotional that was going to make me. That made me so emotional, that first episode on Netflix when they were talking about Korn and like the effect that Korn had on everybody and things like that. Like, that was so emotional for me, because I'm like, damn, like, my boys did that shit, bro. All right. Okay, so here are the lyrics, which is really interesting, especially...
Wait, babe, here's something silly. Did you notice the, what do they call that? Not the guard. The guy that's standing at the front of the stage.
Security guy? Dude, yeah.
Did you see what he looked like?
Yeah.
He looked like this homie, right?
He did. He looked like...
So, I'm like, yo!
That's his brother.
When we listen to the Idol song, Colossus, if you look at the security guard that's in front of the stage...
He looks exactly like the bassist or the guitarist or something.
I was like, yo, it's the bassist.
But, like, it's crazy to me, that guy, he doesn't sing a lot either. He doesn't sing... That guy, like... I think it's said that's the only song that... one of the few songs where he actually...
Yeah.
But he could sing. His voice is buttery smooth,
bro. I don't understand why he doesn't sing more. I have to say, lyrical content, I really don't know what the fuck's going on here. I really, really, really liked the song. And it's weird because I liked the words. I just didn't understand them, really. When I thought I kind of understood, then I got a little confused again.
You liked the words, you just didn't understand them. That's interesting. That's fascinating. Yeah. That's fascinating. Okay.
Just the way, like, because it had, like, a sort of poetry to it. Like, I knock hello, but I see that you've got hypothermia, so I place a block to stop the rot, and I hope that I can warm you up. So I don't know. What do you...
It looks like they're having a fight, and that she's cold. She's being cold to him.
I place a block to stop the rot? Okay.
He says, I knock hello, but I see that you've got hypothermia, which is a way of saying...
you're still mad at me, I think he's saying, or you're still a cold, you know, a person. So I place a block to stop the rop and hope that I can warm you up.
He should listen to that song I showed you last night.
That completely
mad,
forgot it.
The mad one, like, it was like which really one? Chill. Like, I can't remember what they were saying. And then it was like, you're mad.
Oh, you big mad. You big
you
mad.
You big mad.
Oh, yes, yeah, so I'm not going to argue with you.
Yeah.
That's what he said. I can't argue
I
with
can't
you.
I can't argue with you.
You big mad.
Okay. So, do I have to shake you, babe, until you're blind? Why don't? What's that? Like?
Because the next line is, because every light bulb's gone and I'm feeling so inclined. So, you know how you say the light bulb goes off? It's like, ah, yeah. I get it. So I think he's saying is like, you're not understanding what I'm saying, or you're not seeing my point, or mm-hmm. whatever. So do I have to shake you till you're blind? Which is a very interesting line for a man to say to a woman, especially considering he brought his girl out for the show. But I don't think he means it literally.
I
he's just
that was
talking
his
about.
Sister.
He's just talking about the frustration in relationships. I think, where it's like, the person's being cold to you. You're trying to figure out a way to get back into good graces. The person's not feeling it. And then he says, "Can never lay my whole head down. I know I'm lazy, baby, but I will work this time." Like, I think he's pledging to work on himself.
Oh.
Because
I thought the homie was saying he was going to actually get a job this time. And I was like, you know what? That's one thing I really, you know, I'm sorry if there's
like
anybody.
A literal
like,
job? Like a job job?
Yeah,
like
I thought that she was mad at him because he wasn't working or something. Like, I didn't understand the mad coming from verse one. I just assumed that when he was saying, like, I'm gonna work this time. Because I've known people that have been in relationships with guys that they don't work. They won't keep a job. Like, there's always a reason why they have to quit their job.
Uh-huh.
And, like, anytime...
Some people are just not...
Anytime I...
Go ahead.
Like, you play Madden. In my opinion, you play it a lot. Because my dad never played video games.
I play it every day. I try. I commit to myself to play Madden every day, but...
But if you didn't work and you played Madden that much, I would be very, very annoyed.
Sure.
I just couldn't...
I understand.
I can't do it. I cannot do it.
I understand that about you, and I know that about you. But I think I think everybody's like that. Like, if you take like the traditional gender roles, but I don't think that's what he's talking about. He's talking about, I think he's saying, he's gonna work on himself. You know. Like,
well, yeah, once like you said that, I thought that made sense, yeah.
Like, I've seen conflicts with couples where the guy goes, you're just too lazy to do the hard work that needs to be done to solve this problem, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
You know what's funny is, like, our lighting is decent, but it washes your face a little bit.
Yeah.
So, like, everything's kind of... So, like, I'm getting, like, the real... So I looked at you, and I was like, holy shit, she's so pretty. I was looking at you with the thing, and then I looked at you in real life. Holy shit, you're really fucking pretty, bro. Okay. Okay, so he says, I can never lay my whole head down. Okay. So I think that's like, she's stressing him out. She's always pointing out his personality flaws, so he can't get any rest.
Well, when he said, I know I'm lazy, but baby, I will work this time, that's what made me think. That it was like a literal job.
Yeah.
When he said that can never lay my whole head down, I got that as he can't really chill when he's around her. Like, he can never really get that.
That's what I'm saying, because she's at the time pretty exacting. She's a cruel ruler.
Or maybe she's dealt with his bullshit for a long time. Like, wow, we don't know.
Well, obviously, but, you know, it's a dude code, so obviously I'm going to support my brother. So, you know, she's got impossible standards to live up to.
Oh, my gosh.
Which is funny. That's not the complaint in our relationship at all, like, this way. The complaint is that way, the other way. So you too should feel some co-belligerency with this guy.
Wait. Oh.
I put it in a bunch of codes so people can't figure it out.
Yeah, he did.
It's kind of funny that I live
I
the
had to
poetry...
Untangle it.
It's kind of funny that I live the poetry I cannot write, but you, my beauty, shall be fixed forever loosely in my heart.
See,
I
thought that was so beautifully
brilliant
put, but I didn't necessarily like, okay, go ahead, explain.
Well, you will be fixed
So that yeah, sounds
fixed
like
means
it's
you're not going anywhere.
It sounds
yeah.
like it's permanent.
But then he says loosely.
Loosely in my heart.
Yes.
Yeah. And I think that's right. Because the person you want to be for your significant other in your ideal self and the person you actually are in the real world are not the same.
Yeah.
So she's fixed loosely in his heart. Right? Like yeah. so that deals with that paradox of like obviously he'd love to be able to say, yep, you're fixed securely in my heart, but he knows realistically that that's not the case, because otherwise they probably wouldn't be having as much conflict as they do if she was. And obviously he's a rock star, so there are a whole host of temptations and stereotypes as to how the rock star lifestyle mm-hmm. affects relationships. But that to me is the whole thrust of the song. Like, he's promising her, and it's interesting. I do think it's also significant that this is like one of the few songs that this guy did the vocals on, because that means he's really, really trying to say something to his lady. And so, and like I said, like, obviously where he was when he wrote that song and where he is now is, I think, different, because they look like they're getting along pretty good together. I can never lay my whole head down also indicates his inability to focus and commit to anything fully.
That kind of makes sense. You
that's
know, like,
also
yeah.
good, that's a good one.
Yeah.
He's indecisive.
That works too, because he says, I know I'm lazy, baby, but I'll work this time. If you're going with the, I'm going to work on myself. So yeah. he can't fully lay his head down.
Yeah. So he's
that makes sense.
He's indecisive.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, look. I mean, what can you? That's a. But see, that's the thing. But if you don't recognize the frailty of what it means to be a human being. Like, I was in a situation with a dude one time, and he was going through something with his lady, and he kept promising this lady, "I'm never gonna do this again. I'm never gonna do this again," and I said, "Bro." Because I knew where he was at. Because a third party can always, especially if they're friends and you know the person. I remember telling the homie, like, bro, don't say that. Don't make these definitive statements. Like, if you've got a character flaw that you're working on, do not make definitive promises to your mate, your significant other, that you're absolutely changed and that particular thing in your life is over. I think this is much better to say. Like, because this to me is more realistic. And what do you know? It looks like they worked it out, because he brought her on stage to, you know, and she gave him a kiss or whatever. And the song was to her, it looks like. So it looks like they were able to work it out. But yeah. it's a very realistic song, though. It's not, I'm going to change and you change me. I'm going to be better and all. You know, I'm going to be the best I could possibly be. Is... I will work this time, mm-hmm. right? And so I just think that that's a wise way to prosecute your relationships, especially if you've got some sort of recurring thing that your mate is talking about that's bothering him or her.
Dwayne.
Huh?
I just think Dwayne.
You know, I think it's really, really, really important to be realistic in the way you give promises.
I think I agree with what you're saying, but I do think at the same time that every person is different, and what they want to hear, what they need to hear in the moment is also different. So for some people, having somebody say, look, I'm trying this time, might actually piss them off more. Like, some people might want to hear something more definitive, like, okay, like, I'm going to change this. Like, it's going to get better. Or, you know what I'm saying? Like, something that's more solid. And so, if you're that type of person, then you might think that that's the best thing to say to the other person. Like, because a lot of times that's how we prosecute things. Like, for instance, when you talk about love languages and the different love languages there are, if you're the type of person that... gifts is your love language, then you give a lot of gifts to other people regardless of if that's their love language or not. And so in this situation, I think it's like that too. I think that some people don't want to hear, hey, I'm trying. They want to hear, no, this is going to change. There's going to be a difference. I promise that there's going to be a change. And so if that's the type of person they are and that's what they want to hear, they want to hear that sort of like definitive, like it's going to be different. Then they go and say that to somebody else, even if they don't have enough self-awareness to realize that they have not changed internally, and so they're going to keep getting the same results. Like, you can only like BS your way for a span of time, and then who you are is who you are, and that's what comes out, and that's what people see. So, you know, I think that sometimes people don't want to, you use definitive language because you don't want to lose something that you care about. And so you really don't want that. You feel like that person might do something extreme. And so you're saying, let me use some extreme language. I'm never, I promise, blah, blah, blah. When all the while you haven't done the internal work to change. So you have no basis for why you're making that promise, except that maybe it's coming from a place of, you know, I think that sometimes people say stuff like that just to manipulate other people too. Mm-hmm. You know, saying those things makes somebody think that. Also, I gotta go back to the pre-chorus.
Manipulate themselves. Like, I don't think that people have a very good self-understanding.
Yeah.
So they really truly believe. They're not, in their mind, they're not bullshitting. They really truly believe, okay, I'm gonna be different this time.
Well, yeah, because usually when someone's saying that, they're in the midst of dealing, like, with the consequence of their action.
100%.
And so they really, really hate that they got caught. They really hate that they're in the hot water, that they're in that uncomfortable situation. And so they make the promise from that place. Because they're like, I'm never going to put myself in this position again. But if you don't do the work, you're going to put yourself in that position again. The pre-chorus said, do I have to shake you, babe, until you're blind? Because every light bulb's blown and I'm feeling so inclined. That's kind of weird. Like, if you look at it in the... Okay, so if you shake somebody, like... I don't know. You know, like, the only thing that comes to mind is, like, shaking baby syndrome.
Yeah.
Like, that's you shake somebody awesome. Until, like, they can't see... Then he's saying, because every light bulb is blown, and if you're saying, like, that's the ideas or that's the whatever, like, there's no light there. And he's saying, I'm feeling so inclined. Like, it almost kind of sounds like he doesn't want her to realize that every light bulb's blown. And so the only way that she wouldn't see that every light bulb was blown is if she was blind. But then he would have to hurt her or harm her to get her to that place so she wouldn't see how fucked up the situation was.
Yeah.
And I've seen people do that too. I've seen people try to create, you know, gaslight people and maneuver things and try to make the person feel so bad about themselves that they can't see a world outside of where they are. And they just kind of fold up inside that relationship and take abuse for years upon years upon years. And they don't come out of it. And the other person, you know, knows what they're doing, but the person that's being blinded in a sense in the relationship sometimes can't see it. And sometimes it takes somebody from the outside to say, hey, like, can you see what's happening here? But those situations that's difficult, you know, because even if somebody from the outside points something out to you and you see it, you still have to come to that realization yourself, and you still have to do the work yourself to get out of that bad relationship. And sometimes that's extremely difficult to do. But I've seen it a bunch of times where if somebody from the outside tries to get somebody out of a bad relationship, but they haven't made the decision to go, they're going to go right back to where they started. Hmm. You know.
What do you give the song?
Oh, I really like this one, 9.8.
This is my song of the night, 9.8. There is one more song from the band,
man.
Pearl Jam.
Actually, Vin Out, Sorry Out, and before you start the commercial, I have to read something so we can take a poll.
Okay. Vin out.
Sorry out.
Go.
Okay. So Gabe has Pearl Jam, Rockin' in the Free World, Neil Young cover live at Pink Pop.
Okay.
But he said, in this version, Eddie freestyles a bit. Pay attention to this too, because I want your input also.
Okay.
In this version, Eddie freestyles a bit at the start, just a verse or so from the song suggestion from Fugazi and pulled up by Talking Heads, and even a snip of an original song before the band comes out in full to play the Neil Young cover. Also, it's the final song of their set. It's worth mentioning to you and Vin that this version is played right after Porch, the version you saw where Eddie jumped into the crowd from the camera crane. Remember that?
Oh, yes, I do. I do remember that. I was like, yo, he's... This guy was a gangster back in the day. I didn't know he was doing that shit.
He said, I couldn't decide between these two versions. On the one hand, the 1993 version has the original artist out there, which makes a lot of sense. And it's certainly a great version of the song. I do like the Pink Pop 1992 version more, though, but it is without Neil. Maybe put this up as a poll or just ask the chat to vote unless you want to do an executive decision on it. So, do you guys want the 1993 version... It has the original artists out there, and or do you want the Pink Pop 1992 version? But it doesn't have Neil. So if you want the 93 version, you know
Type
what?
22.
Hold on. No, I'm just gonna put up a poll. Or we can't poll everywhere. So
yeah, if you want the
why don't you just have people typing either 92 or 93?
Okay, so if you want the you say the numbers.
Okay,
say the code again.
So 93 is the original artist singing it. You want 93, put 93. If you want the 92 version, that's the Pink Pop version, but it doesn't have Neil in it. So you want the original artist 1993 or the Pink Pop version without Neil 1992. Our DJ likes the 92 version better, just to put that out there. So let the polling begin. Everybody just like spam the chat there so we can see. Look, we're seeing mad 93s.
Let me put the clock. Let me put the clock on here.
93 version has Neil. 92 does not.
But does the 92 version have Eddie Vedder, or is it just Neil?
Everybody's saying 93 that I'm seeing so far.
Okay, I'm playing the clock. Mm-hmm. I got the clock here. When the clock strikes zero, then we'll have our winner, inshallah.
Although most of the 93s are coming from Dwayne. And I'm seeing 92. Oh, well, 92s are coming from a second. Okay, here's two people saying 92. Two people saying 93.
Sick Loso is one person.
Yeah, I know, but that's
who's voted multiple times.
Yes,
three
but
times.
Sick Loco and Zombieholic both said 92.
To clarify, the 93 version is with Pearl Jam and Neil. So 93 is Pearl Jam and Neil. 92 is just Pearl Jam without Neil. I think people are going to want to see him with Neil, obviously. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But we will keep going. We got 57 seconds left, bitches. So it's up to you guys. It's up to you! It's up to you. Y'all didn't know I could sing, huh? Evil people.
Will says 92, Kai says 93, Rob says 93, Abraham says 93, Gabe says 92.
Where is the 93 version at? The 93 version is the Pink Pop one. The name of the song is Free
Rockin'. 92 is Pink Pop. 93 is the original.
Rockin' in the Free World. Rocking in the Free World. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Okay. Let's tally the results, dear listener.
I saw more people voting for 93.
93?
But
yeah, I saw 93 more as well. If it's MTV 93, then that one is badass. MTV Music Awards 93.
93, baby.
Looks like 93 has won, so, and that's the one that he originally posted to us, was the MTV Music Award version. So,
yeah.
93 is with Neil, Kyle. It is, Kai, it is with Neil at the Music Awards. At the MTV Music Awards, so, I didn't have that one downloaded properly. Pink Pop. Go ahead, what were you saying? There it is, 1993 at the MTV Music Awards. What's going on with you?
Well,
are you still counting?
No.
Okay, so what's going on?
I'm looking to see how long the lyrics are, and I'm trying to, like, see. Do we have time to just play both versions, and then are there not a lot of lyrics to break down?
We don't have time.
That's what I was looking at, but I realized there are three verses to it, so.
All right, the 93 version it is. Neil Young with Eddie Vedder and Pearl Jam rocking in the Free World from 1993 MTV Muzak Awards. Let's do this shit. Pearl Jam, let's go.
You noticed that.
Might be.
Keep on rocking in the free world.
Houston.
Did you see that guy?
We're going to have a problem here, Houston.
Wrecking the microphone stand.
That's rock and roll shit, look, bro. Set the guitar on fire, wreck the stand, do that shit. Hopefully we didn't get blocked. I don't think we did.
Tearing it apart. Look, there goes. Did you see this part? He's like smashing the guitar.
Man, they're just wrecking shop. That's rock and roll.
I was like, okay, so the video's playing over there. I've got the lyrics over here. And I'm watching like over there, but the video's a little bit small. I'm like, yo, is he smashing a guitar? And he's so then I'm looking. Then I pulled up the stream over here so I can see all this damage. All right. So, I have to say one thing that I realized. Okay, so on our last stream, I was messaging my dad to get his rating on a song, and then he told me to listen to Whitesnake, Here I Go Again. He said that that's his exact style. Okay. So last night, you know, you were in the shower, you know, when I was supposedly trying to interrupt you, and I was listening to that song. I was listening to that song, and I picked the earliest version of it so I could see them, like, in their, like, prime. And then I listened to, like, a show that was done, like, super recently.
Okay.
And I realized that when I see them when they're old playing, it, like, makes me sad.
How come?
Like, I'm glad that they're still playing, but I'm sad to see, like, their, like, the change in their voice and the way they, like, the aging
process.
Just
the effects of entropy.
Yeah. It makes me sad. And, like, I, you know, obviously we believe that everything's going to flip on the other side. You know, people aren't going to just stay decrepit. But you know what I'm saying? Like,
Roger that.
I don't know. Like, seeing it just kind of... And I sat there for a while. Like, I watched a couple different versions.
He was only 48 in that clip, bro. He looks so much older than 48. But that's what hard rocking will do to you.
Yeah. So, like, seeing this version of it, I was like... I was, like, trying to... I felt like the sad was chasing me because he's older, and I was what did he sound like when he was younger? And,
what year? This was 93.
But he was still going.
This was 93. The song came out in 89. So he had about 4 years of playing it, but he was really into his shit. And
yeah.
Obviously,
it's not like there's like a huge gap of time.
I remember at St. Andre's Catholic School, my brother came home and he was, my brother was always a real... It makes sense that we ended up doing the stuff that we've done and continue to do. Because my brother came home and he was like, our president is a leader of the free world. And I was like, what? He's like, yeah, man. Nobody believes in liberty except for America. And there are other countries that got the idea of liberty from America. But we're the leader of the free world. And I was like, wow. He's like, yeah, bro. We're it. Holy shit, America. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, but it wasn't like, you know, I talk about propaganda and things like that. It wasn't like that, man. Okay, whatever. But I was proud of that as a kid. And you know, I'm still like, hey, look, Kaya's laughing. Like, I'm still like not, you know, like, I'm always holding on to that. I mean, I obviously have a lot of criticisms for America, but, I'm sure it sounds crazy to somebody outside of America, but, you know, like, I love that idea that we could be the leaders of the free world, that we could be exporting, freedom and respecting other people's cultures and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And so part of me is like, you know what, we still have the potential to be that. And so as long as that potential is still there, then it's worth, you know, getting up and fighting for things that seem to be obviously right. But, yeah.
Well, so, like, when I saw it, to kind of, like, I'm hopping back to where I was before. When I saw it, the Whitesnake song that I listened to, the first one was in 87. And then when I watched the 2004 version, that's friggin' almost 20 years later.
Oh, wow.
So it was like a massive jump, and that, it like, just seeing that, like, made me really sad. So when I'm looking at this older version of him, I was thinking that the original version came out the same thing, like, 20 years before.
Yeah.
But only 4 years before was the original. That's crazy.
Yeah, and you know, he talked about he said a man of the people. God, a man of the people says keep hope alive. That's a famous speech from Jesse Jackson. Jesse Jackson got up there in 1984. He's a very, very when I especially in the early 90s, that was a big phrase. You'd see another black person be like, keep hope alive, brother. And dudes would put their hand up in their fist up. Minister Farrakhan was supporting Jesse Jackson. He had this thing called a Rainbow Coalition. He was running for the presidency. And he had a decent shot, and then Farrakhan fucked it up, and so did he. He said something against a certain group of people that you cannot touch in this country. And you want to talk about cancel culture. Holy shit. He said that shit about them folks. It was over for Jesse Jackson.
Shoot, okay.
Over! There's one group of people you cannot fuck with in this country, and it doesn't matter what time period we're in, and it doesn't matter what we've evolved to or past or whatever. You can't fuck with those people. Okay. So this is commentary on stuff, but yeah, that line right there, God, a man of the people says keep hope alive. At the time, it's really interesting to see what has happened with Jesse Jackson, because now modern black folks do not look at him as a voice for us at all.
Mm-hmm.
Because he just sold out so much. I'm not even going to get into the thing, but he sold. I mean, basically, listen, Dr. King was out here doing shit. They killed him. Malcolm was out there doing shit. They killed him. Huey was out there doing shit. They killed him. How the fuck are you still alive? Farrakhan, they tried to kill on a multitude of occasions, try to get locked up and jammed up, all types of crazy shit. But yeah, that was interesting, because he's characterizing Jesse Jackson as a man of the people. And I got to tell you, like, Jesse Jackson, man, he was inspiring. People were saying, like, this is our Martin Luther King. And I remember I went to some, I don't know where we were. I think it was in Orlando or New Jersey, where it's like one of Dr. King's daughters. And then Jesse Jackson was receiving some award. We were there and everything. And so
really?
Like, I grew up like not idolizing Jesse Jackson, but looking at him as like, okay, we got this guy, and then, you know, completely selling out. But at the time, he was a man of the people. It wasn't just black people. He was kind of like a prototypical Obama, but not as smooth, you know. But he had a lot of credentials, because there's pictures of him marching with Dr. King.
Mm-hmm.
He said he was there when King got assassinated, and that King was holding on to him and said, it's your time now, I'm gone. And that was complete bullshit. But yeah, that was really interesting. But if you look at the three verses, I mean, they're all talking about specific stuff that's going on in the country. There's colors in the street, red, white, blue, people shuffling their feet, people sleeping in their shoes. But there's a warning, see right there, people sleeping in their shoes.
Mm-hmm.
It's because you've got all this commodities and all the rest of it. And like I said, prior to 9/11, man, people, Americans, man, we just didn't care about nothing.
Yeah.
And so notice here, they're asleep in their shoes. Which is fascinating, considering the term woke is now pejorative. But every culture has this idea that everybody around them is, how do I say this? Go ahead, you say. I'm trying to say it in a way that's not going to make people miss the point. Go ahead. What were you thinking about the song?
Oh, well, I thought that verse 2 was pretty hard to hear.
I'm sorry. I have to interrupt. But, like, the whole concept, woke is now a pejorative phrase, but, you know, every subculture believes that everybody else is asleep at the wheel,
mm-hmm.
is not paying attention, doesn't know what's going on, and they're not going to find out until it's too late.
Mm-hmm.
And there are obviously historical precedences where that's true. Like, I remember when we were studying the Holocaust at school, there were rumors like, yo, they're doing this to us, blah, blah, blah. But it was so outrageous that people were like, man, get the fuck out of here. You know, Hitler was saying all this stuff about the Jews and the Jewish question, stabbed us in the back, Treaty of Versailles, all this other shit. And a lot of Jews took that and said, yeah, we know where this is going. They bounced. And a lot of the other Jews stayed behind. They're like, nah, man, we're good. Our own countrymen wouldn't do that to us. And then Kristallnacht happened, and then they woke the fuck up. So, like, it's so fascinating now to look at our culture and be like, yo, if a person is awake or woke, now that's a bad term. And of course, one of the I'm not going to... Glenn Beck. Okay. He was talking about... It was the January 6th stuff, and he was saying, are you awake? Do you see what's happening? He's like, not woke! Are you awake? Which, you know, it's like, it's the same thing, bro.
Yeah.
Like, and maybe we could consider that all of us are blinded about something.
Yeah.
Maybe it's not that we're asleep. Maybe people are blinded. Maybe it's a blind spot, because when you're blind and when you're asleep, you essentially see the same thing, physically speaking. Right? So I
yeah.
You know, it's not that I'm awake and you're not, I'm woke and you're not woke. It's I see something in my field of vision that you may not see. And if we look at ourselves as human beings with limitations, then we have to assume that that's going to be correct. Not for that specific person per se, but you have to assume that if you're a human being and you're not omniscient, you're not omnipotent, you didn't even make your eyes for yourself. All the gateways to what you're calling reality were given to you, but in a limited capacity. So if I recognize my limitation, if somebody comes to me and says, you have a blind spot, I have got to take that seriously.
Yeah, it just, people get so offended by that because, I don't know, they think themselves to be a god. It's very weird. It's like, if I had to carry in a king-size mattress, I know definitively I'm not going to be able to lift that up on both sides and bring it up the stairs. I need somebody else to pick up the other end.
Mm-hmm.
And that things are going to get missed if somebody's not on the other end. And I don't understand, like, I was thinking, because you were talking about something the other day, the particular issue that you were talking about, and you brought up how there are different parties that are necessary, and you're saying, like, if it was just you speaking, how people would get one perspective, and if it was just, you know, and you listed off three different people, and all three of you have kind of, like, these different perspectives on the same topic, but all three of you guys are necessary for balance. And I thought, man, if only all of us recognized, if we could all see, like, we know definitively bringing in that king-size mattress that we have a deficiency and we need help. But in areas that are seemingly much more complex than bringing in a mattress, we think that we can have it all figured out and that we don't have a blind spot. We don't have a spot that we're going to be deficient in. We need somebody else. So if we came with that presupposition that I definitely have some things that I'm missing on this topic and I need for somebody to point it out and to help me see so I can gain some balance, then I think we could get somewhere. 100%. But I think people are too busy thinking, oh, they have it all figured out, they know the way, and everybody should listen to them instead of saying, hey, yeah, you have something to say, but so do the other people. So let's all try to start listening to each other so we can get a more balanced view of what's going on.
And not just from a respect perspective, like I respect your right to voice your opinion. People say that all the time.
No.
And that's important. But it's also listening and weighing very carefully. Now that I'm on the other side of the LGBT debate or whatever, there are so many blind spots that I had. Like, I didn't see, for example, the connection between marriage equality or gay marriage and the pro-life movement.
Yeah.
But you're much more likely to get approved for an adoption if you're married than if you're not. I'm sorry, that's part of it. And so... In the main, if they don't have the kind of capital to have a surrogate, a lot of these women are adopting. Mm-hmm. And so there's a clear correlation there between the pro-life movement and marriage equality. But I didn't see that. And when you're around only certain groups of people, then you're not going to get those other perspectives. That was a blind spot.
Mm-hmm.
On my side, you know, and also being pro-life, you know, I said in other reviews, I was pro-war. I was like, people are definitely going to die and good for them. But at the same time, I was calling myself pro-life. I'll never forget it. We're in a car and this person was talking about how they were going to vote for John Kerry because John Kerry was going up against Bush and Bush had brought us into Iraq. And John Kerry was like, yeah, we shouldn't have done that. I made a mistake voting for it. John Kerry had seen combat in Vietnam. I mean, I think he was awarded, not the bronze, maybe the Silver Star Valor device. I'm not sure. But he earned his stripes, in my view, in Vietnam. So anyway, this guy was saying it was G.H., that guy that used to fight with Hal all the time at the Bible study. The little miserable guy with the glasses. Gary is his first name. Anyway.
Anyway. I was never there when he was there.
I never saw that. You were, because you saw one of the meltdowns one time. He was telling me, though, he was like, I'm like, how could you possibly even consider voting for John Kerry? He's not pro-life. And he said, well, neither is Bush. Bush isn't pro-life. I'm like, what are you talking about? I can show you a speech right now where he said he was pro-life. Blah, blah. And he's like, we're in a war right now, killing people. Yeah. And I was like, yeah, but this is...
Yeah. Right, yeah.
You know, and of course, you know, I'm young and stupid. But like, look at this weak, limp-wristed liberal. I was wrong. He's completely right. How could you say you're pro-life? You're bombing the shit out of everybody. Mm-hmm. Like, so it's things like that. Like, yo, bro, I had a crazy-ass blind spot over there. I had a blind spot over here. And so...
Yeah.
I think it's really, really important that this song, man, this is... I'm going to have to give this one a 10, bro. I really appreciate this shit. Really, 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 really appreciate it.
Really?
It's at the 10 for me. What do you give it? And a lot of it has to do with the way that he was performing live as well.
Yeah, he was really putting out. 8.7.
It's a solid 10 for me. And that, dear listener, we must bid you adieu.
Thank you for the stream, Gabe. Dwayne Gabe was asking who that man. Was. That was Gabe's picks for the night.
DJ Gabe.
He kept it funny in some of them, and then some of them got serious, and what an interesting collection.
That's what I'm saying. Like, this is... this was a pretty unique one because there were a couple tongue-in-cheek songs that were, you know, kind of lighthearted, and then the videos were great. I mean, it was worth the block. It was worth the block. Really, really, really good song selection. Very eclectic. Shout out to the big homie Gabe. We gotta give Dave rest in peace, ears. Rest in peace, guys. Get ready. It's about to get pretty loud up in this bitch. But we have got to salute the big homie. We gotta salute the big homie Gabe.
I know, and he had a big long day, and I think they made him stay late.
I know. The fascist bastards over there at what do you call it? Was it Olive Garden?
Yeah.
But that's what the music is, you know, like, no disrespect to anybody, but like, I don't know, man, especially after the Middle America episode I shot, you know, sometimes, like, metal is about the dark side of the world and all that type of jazz, but sometimes it's good to Tenacious D have some fun. You know what I'm saying?
I agree.
We all got together. Everybody was laughing. Everybody was having a good time. Yeah. And I think it just shows, you know, you gotta mix it up. And, you know, this was a godsend of a... You weren't scheduled today. He was actually scheduled on Friday. But this has been a godsend because it's like... kind of resets you after seeing all the fucked up shit. And at the same time, you're still getting deep
music. Well, I thank you, Gabe, for that.
Good job. Good job, Gabe. Much love to you, big homie. We will see you beautiful people tomorrow.
Yeah, we got another stream tomorrow.
Is it 9?
I think tomorrow's is at 9, yeah.
9 Eastern Standard Time, dear listener.
Boop, boop, check
us out. Much love to all you people. Peace to the gods.
Yep, 9 PM.
Out.
Sorry out.
Gone. Love your neighbor. Take care of each other, yeah.